All right, I think we are live. Let me just adjust this for a sec and start by saying good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone. And can I just say, may the fourth be with you, even though where Noah's from, I think it's already the fifth.
Yeah, I know. We already did that.
You already did that. So welcome to today's session. I hope everything's going good. I'm not sure if I can see everyone's comments, but if something's going horribly wrong,
I'll try to find a way to manage the chat for us. Yeah, I think it's stupid that you can't like easily do that.
Yeah, I'm not sure if there's a nice little chat function here as well on the side. I think that is actually just for us. All right, first of all, Suzanne just tells us we're not live. We're not live.
I think you're live, aren't you?
Not even if I refresh it.
It says live.
No, we're definitely live. We're good. I checked.
Yep, now it is.
Yeah? Oh, good.
There's a very long lag. Sorry.
We seem to be having a little bit of lag. So let me just first off post it here that... we are live. People can check out the link right there. We tweet it as well. We are live. All right. And this is hopefully all going to be recorded as well, I think. So first of all, get through the first question. Is this going to be amazing? Yeah.
Obviously,
I asked the question myself, so I think it's one of the best ones there is.
Yep, I think we should spend the next half an hour on it.
Definitely, kind of a heavy question, but I think my short answer would be yeah. So I can mark that as done. Awesome. So we'll get through all the questions in a bit. I thought it'd be good to kind of give a quick rundown for us of what our camp concept design. Is going to be about kind of what the structure is going to be. So 12 weeks, the whole curriculum can be found on the website, artcamp.com. We'll cover anything from thumbnailing, composition, architecture, and so forth. And one of the neat things that we actually have with this art camp is that you get three fictional games to choose from. So we're going to go through all of the games at the start of the course. I don't want to give away too much right now. And really, we're going to simulate that kind of environment when you're in the studio, right? So we're going to see if we can push you to the max stress-wise and forcing you to stick with your design decisions. So I'll be pretty hands-on with it, even though I can't 100% guarantee I'll do personal feedback for everyone. There is a two-hour feedback session every week in which I will rotate people in and out in an attempt to get everyone reviewed anyway, and there's always this big nice emergency panic button that if you're completely stuck, I will of course give you personal feedback. Now, to kind of help out with this whole situation, what we're trying to do is build a community where actually people help each other out. So I will give everyone a portfolio review that signs up, be maybe not one-on-one interaction, but what I will do is I will evaluate people's strengths. Now, based on these strengths, people can earn sort of community badges, right? The badges for perspective, for color and light, atmospheric perspective, stuff like that. And when someone has this kind of badge, what that should tell other people is that, you know, they know what they're talking about. So if you have a problem about perspective and you put it on the forum or you put it somewhere and someone with the badge answers, you kind of know that, oh, hey, yeah, this person knows. And if I see your work during the reviews and it goes like, oh, yeah, you've grown, you understand this topic now, you can, of course, also bring the badge.
Nice. Cool system. Do I get any badges? Can I have a badge? not perspective, but something easy.
You can get a badge. Make a nice special badge for you, of course.
Participation badge.
Yeah. Everyone gets a participation badge and everyone wins. That is guaranteed. In addition to all of this stuff, we will be having some guest artists as well. there'll be a complete list. I'm still working on getting a few more in, but I'm very excited that I can at least announce two. So one will be the very talented Mr. Al Brady, fantastic contemporary designer on anything sci-fi. His work is absolutely wonderful. It's super cool to have him on board. So he's going to be providing a demo for all of you as well, which I think is pretty nice. And another really cool thing is that if you sign up, you are eligible, or five of you will be eligible, to get a full portfolio review from the one and only Mr. John McCoy. And for those who aren't familiar with John McCoy, he's a concept artist for many, many years. He's an awesome guy. He's super cool. And he works in London for NPC. So he's working on a lot of cool big films and big things. And he's outstanding when it comes to environment concept design. He's packed. Like, his calendar is completely packed. I know he would have loved to do a demo, but he's doing five portfolio reviews for five lucky winners instead. So I think that's super awesome.
That's exciting.
Yeah. So I think for now, we can start by answering a few questions, then going to the portfolio reviews. I have a whole bunch of them right here. I think a crazy amount of people send in stuff to review, so I'll be doing that while talking. But first, I think there are a few questions we've been on here for like almost the whole day, and there's this cool upvoting system, so we can see. So let me just select this question right here. By Jeffrey Talbot, who asks, when studying, should we focus in on one area, say characters, or should you try to study as many areas as possible? I have this question because I want to draw everything, so I draw completely different things each time I put pen to paper and improve slowly. So what do you think, Noah?
I don't know. I think it depends on sort of where you're at, because I think really early on, it does sort of help try everything. I don't know. I think it probably goes in cycles of studying very broad things and then studying very narrow things and then studying broad things again and going kind of back and forth like that all the time. Because, like, for instance, if you want to learn how to draw human figures, at some point you will have to narrow it down to specifics of the figure, for instance. You'll have to learn how to draw an arm. And you'll have to spend a lot of time learning how to draw an arm. But if you just start out drawing the hell out of arms, you're going to be a terrible character artist. So I think there's like some balance there between like studying everything to studying just a few things. So I don't know. What do you think?
Absolutely. Well, I think, like you said, it depends heavily on where you are and kind of where you want to go, right? I mean, breaking into the industry, especially for concept art, is super difficult unless you're really specialized in one thing. But in order to be specialized in one thing, you kind of have to know a little bit about everything before you can make like an informed decision. On a basic level, a lot of stuff is the same. A lot of stuff is perspective and volume and mass and you know. So people in studios kind of do expect you to know a little bit of everything as well. So I think specializing is kind of good. Because it's also quite fun. You can really, you know, bite down on one thing that you really enjoy, but it does take a lot of experimentation before you know what you want to do, right? I did a whole bunch of characters before I realized I really don't like doing characters, and I'd much rather do environments instead. You know, I've done that for a few years, I'm like, oh, actually, you know what? Nah, characters, they are pretty cool. They kind of have their merits, so and switching up again. So pretty long answer, but I hope that that kind of marks that one down. Click done. Let's see. We are getting heaps of questions. That's awesome. So next one, by Suzanne. How do you narrow down an idea into a simplistic shape to get the feeling or story across as good as possible? Meaning, to what will you need to narrow it down? What is the bare minimum? I think kind of a big part of the foundation for me would be the mood for environments. Mood. Yeah. That's kind of where it all starts from, right?
That's definitely, I don't know. It's kind of hard now that I'm thinking about it. But, I mean, it all is about shapes. Yeah. And I guess for me personally, it comes down to coming up with cool compositional shapes. And it doesn't matter what I'm painting at all. If I have cool compositional shapes, I know I can paint something into those shapes and it will turn out to be a cool looking painting. But if I don't have those shapes to start out with, it's just going to be a mess the whole time. So I'd say shapes for me, just weird abstract shapes.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of what we base the mood on, right? You can represent the mood with a lot of abstract shapes as well. Just basic shape language, you know, triangle for aggressive and circle for and rounded shapes for not so aggressive. So there's a lot within that that, you know, if you establish the mood and you know the shape language to go with it, you can make this super abstract piece where you're just looking for kind of, you know, interesting shape surfaces and interesting attention. So I don't think you really have to narrow it down to something recognizable as long as that super base form language that you that you know the theory of kind of makes sense. See, next question. This one came in. I'll select it. Quick question. Why do both of you have the same style facial hair? Do you both shave together naked? Well, hard to answer.
So, yeah, no comment.
no comment on the last bit. Done. All right. Let's go. There's another upvoted one. Should we create a personal website or just art station? Will that do the job as well? Are there any bonuses to having a personal website rather than selling stuff on it? I don't know. Do you do a lot with your personal website?
I mean, I update it occasionally. I updated it this past year for the first time in like 4 years.
There you go.
That's... You know, not a lot. I guess the portfolio tends to sit there for a while, and it gets you jobs for sure, but it does tend to do a lot more sitting there. So I don't know. I mean, when I started out, I had a trashy DA portfolio thing, which they're actually not bad. They're cleaner designs than most people put up online. So, you know, they got that going for them. But, yeah, I don't know. I think for a while, something like ArtStation could serve you well. But I think in the end, establishing your own presence on the web is really valuable. I realized that more and more the further along I've gotten, you know, when I've basically like ditched my Facebook page and all that stuff, because when certain platforms start screwing you over, you kind of give up on them. So.
Facebook is a tricky one. I guess the main question about this is, do you want exposure or do you want more like a, I don't know, like building up a brand identity? Because if you just want exposure, then sites like ArtStation and stuff are fantastic because they give you so much for free, right? But if it's a brand identity that you want, you might want to slowly move away from that. You know, we see a lot of artists move away from, you know, ArtStation, Facebook, all that kind of stuff, just because it doesn't fit their brand identity anymore. So I think in the beginning, have it as many places as possible just so people see your work. And after that, you can slowly figure out where you want to go.
Yeah.
Cool. All right. Let's see. Quick question about the art camp thing. How many slots are there? Infinite. Infinite amount. Once we
reach 7 billion slots.
I think once we reach like 2 million, it might be tricky for the Facebook page, but I think we should be. I might be close, but I think we should be good. So unlimited slots. Obviously, the more slots are filled, the more it will be about community building, obviously, and the more it's hopefully kind of a self-sustaining thing, which would be great. All right, so I think questions keep. Wow, there's a lot of questions. Jesus, someone says good morning, Noah. Enjoy the coffee.
Already did. Coffee's gone. No more coffee.
Already did. Good. That was fast. You might want to duck out and get some.
We're switching green tea now. So we're good.
Okay. let's see. I'm just kind of sifting through these. They're weirdly enough not really in order.
Yeah, okay. I don't know what system Google's using here.
Technical question. Random order. Hey guys, might seem odd, but I would like to know which tablet model do you prefer, Cintiq or Intuos? I find that each have pros and cons. I wanted to know what you think is best when it comes to concept art and speed. Thanks. I think it's completely unrelated to concept art and speed. It's just what you prefer. I prefer a Cintiq.
Yeah. And you got a companion these days, right?
I got a companion these days. I have got a companion. It does have a few problems, the companion too. Like weird getting stuck on update, but that's apparently a Windows thing and not necessarily anything else. But drawing on a screen for me is great. Once I switched, I kind of lost the will, the sheer will to do it on a tablet ever again. It's just on the screen is easiest for me. So.
Yeah. I'm just a Surface Pro these days. But I will say that when my companion died, mysteriously and suddenly, I picked up a little, the tiny Intuos, whatever they're called, and the smallest size too, and painted on that for probably 2 or 3 months. And I actually really loved it. I loved going back to it because I hadn't used one in a few years. I don't know. It was just kind of fun. I was like, this is awesome. It's like it's a whole new experience. So. And as I often say, I had a Graphire 4 for 7 years. I built my career on the little thing. It's falling to pieces, but it's all you need. So,
if it works, it works.
People get caught up on the tools, but they don't matter that
much. No, it's all about personal preference. All right, mark that. Done. That's another one. Done. Very quick one that I saw and it already... it already scrolled out. I can't find it. Oh, here it is. I'll select it because if I select it, people can find it back. How much does art can cost right now up until it starts? $225. And then when it starts on June 24th, which is my birthday, just saying official launch
day. Birthday
party. It's my birthday. So everyone gets a piece of virtual cake, not real cake. It will go up to $250. But before that, $225. Done.
Which is super ridiculously cheap.
It's about as cheap as we can make it, I think, without really because
for a 12-week course with instruction. Yeah.
Because people don't really you warned me before this, like it takes a long time to set this up. That's no joke. It takes a long time to set it up. Like a long I had to buy an extra 1 terabyte hard drive to store all the files because I was like, oh, week two is done. Actually, not that happy. I'll do it again. I'll write the script. I'll update the script.
Jeez. Yeah, it's a lot of work.
It is a lot of work. Let's see. Here's a plus four one. Select a plus four. How do you guys personally practice and train your design sense? Like a sixth sense?
I don't know. You go for this one.
Grapefruit.
You have a better design sense than I do. So
nonstop consumption of grapefruits.
They are delicious.
I don't know. Like design sense is I think really closely linked to whatever is inspiring you. Right. You know. Then and there, it could be a weird architect or an illustrator or you know whatever. I think honing your design sense is again. Tied into the ability to simplify shapes. So when you're in the habit of simplifying shapes a lot because you have to set things up for composition, you tend to look at things a little differently. You tend to pick out other kind of elements of stuff that you find interesting. So it becomes much more of a, oh, I find this interesting, and then you mix and match it with something else, and either it works or it doesn't. That's kind of how you refine it. Refining design sense sounds pretty elegant, but I think it's more like hacking away like a madman and everything you find interesting and hopefully some cool pieces will fall in your lap that you can then add to your own design portfolio.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
It doesn't feel
I don't do as much design work as you do. I guess these days I'm much more of an illustrator. So I'd say as far as design relates to me, it's more composition. And as far as composition and how I train that, I did a ton of like simplified master studies of really good illustrators. It's one of the best ways to train yourself. And then just doing tons and tons of thumbnails in general. If you do enough of them, you start to figure things out. And especially if you do enough like landscape environment ones, you start to like get a good feel for like what makes a good environment, how you need to structure things. Lots of thumbnails.
Yeah, observation is definitely a key part of that, for sure. I think we got two art camp things coming up. Let's do those. You mentioned in the who is this for section on the art camp website that the level required is intermediate slash advanced. Can you elaborate a bit more on that, perhaps? Do you encourage to join even if one is not that experienced with portfolio? So that's actually a good one, because what I mean by that is that I will go into some fundamentals, but I won't go into everything about the fundamentals, right? So it's not like from the ground up. Obviously, there will be stuff that I will cover because some of the compositional techniques that we use are a little bit more complex and some of the perspective. But if you have no clue whatsoever about any rules of composition or any rules of perspective, this might be a difficult course for you, because 12 weeks is not a long time. It sounds like a long time, but it really isn't. So the pace will be quite high. All right. So if you are, if you've been doing this for a while, you kind of know some of the basics. You have a normal brain that can learn things at a normal pace, you'll be fine. If you have never picked up a brush or pencil or Wacom pen before to paint, maybe this is not for you. That's it. Done. And the other one, what is the mindset behind the structure of the 12 weeks? How do 1 week build up upon less, and how do the whole thing is wrapped? Was there anything important left out? So kind of like, I think what ties the whole structure, how did it came to be? Right. So I think for you just pick like all the super important fundamentals. Yep. Right. And just so it's clear, there was a discount, right? If you go for mine and
Yeah. If you do yours and then get mine, it's like 300 for all the stuff that I've done. So relatively cheap for the stupid amount of material you get. So if you feel like having 150 hours of like videos to watch, then there you go.
And 350 hours of homework every week.
Exactly. Good luck with that.
So for me the 12 week course, I divided it into three blocks. So the first 4 weeks is the actual fundamentals and the stuff that you need to know in order to start as a concept artist, because there's a certain way of thinking that's slightly different than illustration, which we'll work on in the first 4 weeks. So what does composition, these thumbnails mean when you're doing them for concept art? And then obviously as a concept artist for environments, there's two big chunks that you can do, interior and exterior. And the shot design and architecture and the way you approach those is actually completely different. So I split those as well. So I haven't left anything out. The only thing that I might have left out is part of the fundamentals. But like we discussed before, you can get that from Noah's stuff, and you can get the big bundle. But luckily, I didn't really need to leave anything out for this one. So you'll get a really good all-around package, luckily. Yeah. Cool. All right. So last one I'll do about that, and then I'm going to do so stuff. Can you join the art camp even if you are not that good in concept or painting? I'm mainly a 3D artist, but still want to improve my 2D skills. From a concept point of view, 3D is really big and is a very useful tool. So definitely when we reach the stages of the easy image creation, you should be fine. All the composition elements should be easy to translate, right? This is not about rendering. We're actually going to go very little into how to render an image. That's mostly illustration. So like I said, I think the only big hurdles is are you familiar with all the base concept, perspective, and all that kind of stuff? And then the rest will kind of hopefully figure itself out, because you're going to be doing a lot of painting, a lot of thumbnails, a lot of researching. So you should learn pretty fast.
Yeah. Oh, I can go ahead and take that one about the last art camp and the difference between...
Who's...
showed up on Andre?
Andre Blanc, what's the difference? Okay, so...
I can go ahead and take that.
Yeah, go for it.
So the difference is huge. This is sort of where I always imagined art camp eventually going. Art camp started out originally as a very strong fundamentals focused course. It's for people who had no idea how to be a better artist. But when it, why is everything red?
Did everything dramatic effect.
Oh. Anyway. everything very, very fundamental focused in the original art camp and art camp two. Art Camp 2 sort of fleshed out everything I missed in Art Camp 1. So from there, you not keep doing fundamental stuff. I covered as many exercises as I humanly could. I could not think of 12 more weeks of exercises for Art Camp. So from there, you sort of have to start specializing. You have to find something to specialize in. And concept art is definitely one of the directions we wanted to specialize in. So sort of once you have a general grounding in those fundamentals, I think it's a good idea to start finding a specialization. And whether you already know what it is or you want to start trying out specializations, that's sort of what this course is for. The environment concept design is to give you a general understanding of what concept design is, what environments are specifically, and how to do all that stuff. It's sort of a notion of things.
Nice. Cool. That is pretty well put. Nailed it. Done. See, I saw one down here that I put a star in, but wait, did it bump it to the top? Does every star thing? Okay, cool. Let's see. I think this is kind of a 2-4. Yeah, this is going to be a 2-for-1. So first of all, this says, what separates ArtCamp from the other video resources available today, Gumroad, YouTube, etc. I'm going to tie that into scene course question. Does Titus' course include homework and feedback for students? And it's not a stupid question. So what separates it, first off, is the homework, because there's going to be tons of it. And what separates it even more is that there are going to be feedback sessions, not just from me, which is going to be 2 hours every week, in which I will try to rotate as much people around, so hopefully everyone gets a chance and gets reviewed, and also from actually the community. So what you do with a Gumroad is they're super good because they're cheap, but you buy them, you view them, and if you have questions, that's kind of it. Here, you get a ton of videos, you get a ton of homework, and then you have a community which can help you out. And then when it goes clearly wrong and you're in panic mode, you can talk to me and I'll help you out and I'll review. So I had a fun little blurb about types of homework, about week 1 and 2. And I'll read it right now. So what you can expect for week 1 homework. 1. Write a small one-page essay for yourself about why you paint and what you want to achieve artistically. Not where you want to work, but where you see yourself 30 years down the road. It's actually a pretty tricky exercise, and everyone I do with, it's hilarious. It's hilarious. 2, take a good look at your workspace and rearrange it so it's optimized based on the things we discussed. Post a picture of your desk on the forum. Nice. I have a lot of Star Wars stuff, so that's going to be all the stuff on there. You'll have to make a list of stuff you want to get better in. I'll have 3 fictional games that you can work on, so you can read through the descriptions of that. Then you need to make reference folders. You need to start doing 15 black and white thumbnails in the first week. You have to write down ideas about what you want to do for the games, and then try to ignore them altogether. And then there's a whole lot more thumbnails, list of questions you're asking. So because this is a concept art thing, we're going to focus a lot on your motivation, right? And one of the key things that's going to be a lot different is that every time you make a decision or have to make a decision for the course, I will ask you to make a file in which you write down why you made the decision. Your fellow students can ask you this and I can ask you this. Because the only thing you can actually never say as a concept artist is, I don't know. So why did you paint this? I don't know. Why is this pipe here? I don't know. Can't do that. Cannot do that. That's a huge no-no. So we're going to get rid of that straight away. So yes, lots of homework, and that's the difference.
Yeah, I think that's it's a huge, huge difference. The interaction community aspect of it, direction to things, is really what sets it apart. I mean, that's what like set our camp like originally apart, was that there was all of this same material everywhere else. It's not that hard to find fundamentals exercises, but when they're laid out in a nice and structured way and you get the mindset behind it as well, it makes a huge difference on how people improve. So
absolutely. Ooh, excuse me. So what I'll do is I'll answer a few more questions, and then I'll probably ask questions while I'm doing the review thingies. I'll start doing that, but there's a few more I want to answer with 100% undivided attention. Let's see. Boosh, here it is. Question for me. Yeah. Sorry, Noah. Do you actually draw and design during production or just do painting? I remember Shadi Safadi said that they don't do that stuff anymore and that they only do paintings, but I'm not sure if he was talking about his studio. That's a thing. It kind of depends on the studio. But as a concept artist, you actually always draw and paint. We make tons of tiny little scribbles and drawings. This is one of the things that I'll teach during the course as well, is how and when do you know to make what painting, right? Do you always make a painting? Do you make a line sketch? Do you make a red pen annotation? Do you talk to people? How do you figure that out? That's actually a pretty complicated and weird process that you have to go through, because the expectation is that you actually do make paintings all the time, because that's what most people think is your job, right? You can make pretty pictures, so why don't you make pretty pictures all the time? Learning how to be a good concept artist is learning how to distinguish who to listen to and when and how all that stuff works out. So if you're working as an outsourced studio, it might be that you never actually do designs and that kind of stuff during production. You know, I don't know if you get to work on that kind of stuff. Definitely when you're in-house, you do, because what a lot of people don't know is that game development is not a linear process. It's one of the most ridiculously chaotic processes ever, and everything kind of happens at the same time. And you're the person who needs to figure everything out most of the time. So it's just kind of, you know, done. Let's see, a few more questions. This one's a good one. Thank you, Titus.
You're welcome.
And another one, the final outcome of the course, how many finished pieces should we expect to have completed by the end of 12 weeks? Could that be something to start building up a portfolio from and keep working on it after art camp? Totally. The main goal is to set you up with stuff that could go in a portfolio. Mind you, because concept artists should do more than making pretty pictures, you should have other stuff than finished pieces. So the aim is to have four super finished pieces and a buttload of thumbnails and all the tools you need to keep building on that stuff. Pretty self-sustaining. It's awesome that way.
That's a pretty solid start with portfolio, honestly. You wouldn't need that much more after that.
Yeah, because a lot of people, they think as well, like, oh man, do I need like 500 pieces in my portfolio? And little fun fact, art directors tend to look on average about 30 seconds at every portfolio, which means they can digest about 5 to 6 images. If you're good, you need to show more. If you are good and you don't have more because your portfolio is small, they will at least ask you for an art test, which is your foot in the door. If you have 600 images and they're all mediocre, he will stop looking at 3, and then what's the point, right? So,
yeah. Having done as many portfolio views as I've done, which is like a fraction compared to an art director, you realize that it's a very quick process to see where someone's at. You can tell in the first couple images, like, oh, okay, this is exactly where their skill level is at. Sometimes they might surprise you. Sometimes they'll start out with their mediocre stuff, and all of a sudden they get awesome a few pieces in. But that's extremely rare.
Yeah, absolutely.
So quality over quantity.
Yeah, isn't that the truth? All right. I'm always looking at others' works, and lately I realized that a lot of people have this realist feel in their work that mine won't get. Is that values that make it more believable? Do you study values for environment and characters differently? Do you study values differently? I'm not sure if you study them differently per se, but to the topic of study values, like, yes.
Yeah, do that a lot.
That's fairly important. The only thing that I can think of that's the one of the big differences between characters and environments is that environments get the lovely atmospheric perspective, which changes values quite heavily. And knowing how to play with that and when to change them and how much is a key difference. But I'm sure that in the same way, characters will have something that that kind of changes that. But also, realistic is not that important. Realism is kind of a tricky one as well. Is it photobash realism, or is it this lighting is 100% correct realism? Because they can both look really real and really different at the same time. I think having images that make sense in the world that you make them works, because we already, you know, we know the big ones, and even the super big names out there, you name them, they will have images where they have three or four different main light sources, like two or three suns and six vanishing points on two different horizons. And you're like, they know they're doing it weird, but they know exactly what they're doing, so it looks cool anyway. Is it realism?
Yeah.
You know, technically, technically no, but it sure looks that way. So yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, make it look cool, and no one will ask questions. Make it look cool.
Maybe your art director. All right, so I will grab. I will start grabbing things, and I will start sharing my screen as well. So let's see. Can I share my screen to everyone? Scary.
Yeah, you should be able to.
Boom! Everyone's seeing this. Awesome. This is an image by Fenris.
Nice.
Awesome image, Fenris. Really like the topic. Cool composition. So this is a good way for everyone to get used to the way I actually give feedback, which is kind of chaotic. Some of the people who have done courses for me already might recognize this. So what I do is I grab my trusty super orange brush, which actually in this case is the worst color, but you know, whatever. And I start marking things down with circles and stuff. So let's start doing that. One of the things that I think is happening here is that this triangle composition is very strong because it encompasses everything, which is good. One of the disadvantages is that it creates this awkward negative space over there, which is actually quite tall or quite big. And when I see something like that happening, one of the things that I often do is quickly make a viewfinder. So create a layer, which is black. Whoops, get the rectangular marquee. And I just mask it out. And I start moving this around, right? So I try to find if there's a stronger composition within the frame already happening, because we often forget that readjusting the frame can lead to cool new things. And actually, maybe if we go a little bit more extreme, we find something that works better. So in this case, if I start cutting into it a tiny bit, that space actually is reduced quite significantly. And now the balance of these colors in the top here start balancing this out, which is actually quite cool. So always do a kind of little pass like this, right? Should you do that, Noah? Is that something that you sometimes do? Or
I definitely think of like recropping things, and I have told many people to cut off a large portion of their so yeah,
absolutely. Cutting stuff off.
I don't do it as much actually, scratch that, I do readjust my composition. I was about to say that I didn't do it on my own, but I definitely do it on my own stuff. It's pretty rare painting, actually, that I don't, you know, shrink my thing, add some extra to the borders, crop it in, maybe. So, yeah, sometimes I will move my own stuff around as well.
Yeah. See, one of the things is, this is some of the thumbs that I've been working on, which are actually also in art camp that I'll take further. So this is that weird little... what you can call it, you know, when you do these super abstract ones. Very fun.
Yeah.
And when you do these, what you're trying to do is you're trying to eliminate the problem of framing pretty early on, right? So when I see things like this where the framing could be a little better, I think, yeah, if you start from that kind of thumbnail, you won't run into that problem maybe as much. Usually when you check it, you go like, oh, actually, no, I was kind of happy with how it was. So there you go, Fenris, cool image. And I have to kind of go a little bit faster in speed. Let's see, this guy's a portfolio, so I'll get to that in a sec. So first off, we will do this one by João Pedro. I was saying that wrong. I know I'm saying that wrong. I cannot not say that say that wrong. It's a pretty cool image. This is someone when they're talking about values and how important they are. Because what's happening here, it's a cool example of that one. So the values in here are actually pretty good, right? This fade,
yeah,
that's really good. However, the light source in here, that could be a little stronger. I think that could pop a little bit.
No, I was convinced by that, but that general like soft gray lighting they got going on, that I really like.
Yeah, exactly. This is great. It provides for a good fade. One of the issues that you'll have, however, is when you make this more intense, this is actually the viewing direction. You're going that way, and when you have a large section over here, because we're viewing it from left to right, we're reading it counter gradient, because we read gradients dark to light. So we really want to read it from top right to bottom left. And if we increase this guy's light, we're kind of messing too much with that. So if this light would be placed on this side of the composition, right in that viewing angle, right, because the characters we view is important, that would work really well. Then you get the flow going. So actually anywhere within, this happens a lot. I have to change. Sometimes I go to three or four different colors. It's a mess, right? So anywhere in here would work really well, and then you can kind of cut off that part of the painting.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. I like it.
Lightning speed going through that. Actually, it's time for another question. Hey guys, is location very restrictive to your art career? For instance, is it possible to keep working mainly from a digital presence rather than being physically near your employers, like your past job at Ubisoft, Titus? Well, I moved countries a bunch of times, and I think Noah just takes the cake in moving around.
Yeah, it doesn't. I mean, I don't do as much concept stuff by far than you do, but no, location has never been that restrictive. It does seem like it would be a huge advantage to make things easier if you're surrounded by studios and other game people, but I don't know that it's necessarily at all a limiting factor if you're not.
The only problem that you could run into is that people are not comfortable with freelancing unless you have some sort of base experience, you know? So. Yeah. That's to say, if you are very new in the industry, you probably have to be in the studio. And once you rack up a few years of experience, they kind of let that go. So I think from actual getting into the industry, you really have to have an open mindset, because you might have to move. But then again, that's not really a bad thing. Seeing stuff of the world is awesome. Working in a different country is awesome as well. You'll see new people, new cultures. So I'm just a big advocate of moving around anyway, regardless of whether you have a job or not. Just kind of just do it.
For sure.
All right, let's share the screen again. This one is done by Matthew. Oh man, these names. People need to get like easier names, like Dave. If everyone's just called Dave, even the girls called Dave. I'm sorry, girls. You come up with a more awesome girl name. No, but if you come up with a more awesome girl's name to call everyone, put it in the comments.
And Davina.
Davina. We'll call everyone Davina. Awesome. One thing I'll say about this one, this is a mistake that happens a lot. This is a very, very basic lesson in composition. Get ready. So composition occurs when you have two lines that either touch or cross. That is the very, very basic bases of composition. And that kind of means, in order to do that, you cannot have a line running the whole length of the canvas, horizontally or vertically, uninterrupted. Because what that does is it splits the canvas in half, and it prevents us from looking there. So we have a character here. He's blocked by this guy, and by this guy, and by this guy, and by this guy. So from a very 2D point of view, he's actually not looking beyond these trees. Right? He's not actually even looking beyond this tree. Whereas, so the focal point gets completely lost. So this is why forests are kind of a pain to do right, because you can't just cut the screen in half, especially not before the focal point. So having a tree right here and the dude on the inside of it is fine. If this focal point would be on the inside of these trees as well, like this guy would be removed or be pushed back really, really far so we can see the depth. Cutting stuff and blocking stuff, generally not a great idea. Boom. Another one. Dropping some serious knowledge, man. Oh, this is a character. This is going to be a character. I'm going to have you comment on the character stuff as well. There you go. This one's by Anil Duyal. Dave. Anil Dave Davina Duyal. There you go. I'm marking some questions down as well. Okay, so this question keeps getting upvoted. I'll do the question. Does Titus's course include homework and feedback for students? Yes, it does. It includes a ton of homework, which is also the next question, which I'll answer after this one. So I'll mark this as done, and mark this and go select and say, what does a ton of homework really mean? Well, it means that on average, you have to be ready to spend between 8 and 14 hours a week if you want to do most of it, which is a lot. And I don't expect everyone to do everything, because that would be kind of crazy, because I know you all have schedules and lives and stuff that you actually want to do. But simulating that real world environment where the stress could be high, you have a ton of things to do, and learning how to prioritize what is actually important and what the art director or fictional art director needs to see is kind of a bonus of making the workload that high, right? You have to make very informed and conscious decisions. You can't just kind of, you know, flail around and do stuff. So that's what a ton means. All right, cool. So with this one, I think what's happening is that the values are a bit stronger. The saturation is a bit strong. If we look at levels, another cool thing, if you don't know it, histogram. Is the histogram your friend, Noah?
Oh, yeah, sort of. I don't know if I actually look at it, but I think about it. It's nice in photography.
Yeah.
Using photography.
So this is a tool that's very useful when you're starting out and you're wondering, you know, are my values good, or are we going too light and too dark, that kind of stuff. You can see it because basic version, left side is black and the right side is white. And if you hover over your thing, you can actually get to see, well, not in this one, but you can actually see how much pixels stuff there are. So actually look at in here. You can hover over stuff and kind of see how much it is. So if I try to hover over level 0, oh man, I always hate this. There's an easier way, right? It has like a fuck ton, like 15,000 in pure black. So that means there's zero color information. You just don't see that in the real world. You never go full black, right? You don't never go full retard, and you never go full black.
Nope, never do it.
No, don't do it. So output levels right here at the bottom, you at least put 3. Please never go 3, because that means that you have at least 1 point of every color. That means you can have a very weird gray that's nearly full black. I don't think you can even get this black in nature. And same for the 255. Please put it a little lower. Have your light.
I like going 255. I like going pure white.
You would, because it's all the glowy stuff. Okay, so 255 is okay if you have a tiny glowy thing or an actual light in the background here, a full-on like lightning bolt. You could do it.
Who does have a lightning bolt?
You gotta have lightning bolts, so this is true. Okay, rephrasing. Going to 255 is a little less scary than going to zero. Please don't go to zero. There's just nothing in that value range for you. Basically, anything in this kind of value range, really right down here, you almost never have to go in here. This is a weird place. Weird place to be. So there is that. So for this one, I would say, pay close attention to the values that you are using. Okay. This one actually comes with a question. By Raja Nandibu. He asks, "What is wrong with this? Is this a boring angle, and how do you make it more dynamic?" Well, this is, if you break it down to the simple shapes. All right, want to do that? Break it down to the simple shapes. You have a line here, you have a line here, two verticals, a horizontal, and cross. Okay, so basically, this is your image. And as we can see from this view, there is not a single diagonal in there, not one. Diagonals usually kind of help you create interest because they kind of show perspective, right? Or anything to make this look like it's not a flat plane. Because one of the tricks of art is actually creating the illusion that the flat surface you're working on is not a flat surface, that you're looking through this kind of window, right? So when you simplify the image like this, it's actually very simple to see where the problem is, a lack of diagonal. And I don't really mean this diagonal, because this is still on a flat plane. If you were to have this diagonal and a very strong diagonal doing this here, we might be able to see some depth in this face. But we don't, because there's a gradient. So there you go, sir. That is what is wrong with that, in case you were wondering. So, we're covering a lot. We're covering a lot.
All kinds of stuff here.
Oh.
So many questions.
Another question. So, like this one, would you guys include fan art in an online portfolio if there are some sort of your best pieces, or is fan art simply a portfolio? No.
I'd say generally to avoid it, but in certain cases it's fine.
It's a dangerous thing. That's the problem. If it's done really, really well and you reinvent part of it, it could be really fun and good.
Yeah.
However, bad fan art is like a portfolio killer, like instantly kills it.
Yep.
So if you're not 100% convinced that you got it right and you're making this cool special tribute that no one has ever seen, probably best to avoid it. But it's a difficult one, especially difficult because I have like a Dragon Ball image in there, and I think like some Blade Runner stuff.
It's sort of one of those things that if it is phenomenally well done, then you can do it. But if it's not,
All right. So next question: to prepare a portfolio environment, is it valuable to take a license like an old movie or book that everyone knows, like 2,000 Leagues or 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, or like the brainstorm topic and make it a full portfolio of that? This is kind of like the fan art, but it's less fan art-y because you take something as a base and then you go from there. So what I'll say about that, like one of the problems that people run into is that they say, I can't get a job because they don't have enough experience. And by experience, what the people at the game studios most often mean is that you don't have experience following direction or following our project guidelines or completing all that kind of stuff. This is kind of what they're wary about. Like, are you good at painting because you get to do your own thing, or are you good at painting because you're good? So actually then picking a familiar topic, not necessarily fan art, but a familiar topic like an old book reimagined, will help show the people that you're applying to that you actually do know how to stick to art direction and how to complete a project in that kind of way. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I think from what I've seen as of concept art goes, I mean, the whole point of concept art is that you have some sort of concept. And if you're painting pretty pictures, you're not really being a concept artist. You're not trying to, you know, come up with a cohesive design for things and not really pursuing things like that. You can get away with that kind of in illustration. You can kind of get away with just painting pretty pictures, but even then, if they don't have any substance behind them, they sort of feel lacking. So, yeah, I'd say in general, having something to back up your work is great. I always love the idea of like using stories and stuff and like hashing out cool like sci-fi versions of them. I hated actually doing it, so I've never really done it. But I think it is a great idea if you can actually find the motivation to do it.
Absolutely. If you're in that position, then definitely, definitely go for that. All right. let's see. I'm just looking at the amount of upvotes. People, if you see a question that you think is important and I'm missing it, please keep upvoting it so I can actually see it, because there is an insane amount.
There's enough in there that we are not seeing all of them.
Yeah, okay, so I'm going to go to the next one. When you work on a personal project or blue sky, how do you like to resolve the overall art direction, color palette, mood, shape, language, etc.? Also, your thoughts on self-art directing. Well, self-art directing is exactly like we just talked about. It's quite difficult to do properly in the way that it's difficult to convince other people that you're doing it properly, because you might have all these ideas in your head, but if you don't show them, then that's tricky for other people to kind of test your work to the set of rules that you made. So if you do self-art direction for your own project, make sure you make an art Bible and an art guide beforehand, right? Show, look, I made the art Bible, I made the art guide, this is what I'm sticking to, and then do the rest of the thing. And coming up with all that stuff about color palette, mood, and shape, that's just your research. That's super important. You have to be able to back up your research. Same as what we're doing with the homework. This is why I'm going to have people write down documents of why they did certain stuff, because it has to make sense, and they have to get in the habit of other people telling them, this doesn't make sense, why'd you do that? You have to be able to defend that. You know, nothing's worse than being in a studio, not doing your research properly, making a mistake, and someone goes like, what's up? This is weird. Why'd you do that? And you're like, I don't. So we're gonna get rid of that little annoying problem early on by talking a lot about that kind of stuff and making sure that doesn't happen. So self art direction is being able is the ability to back up what you do. That's it. Whichever way you find most comfortable in showing that, which you think that other people understand as well, is the best way you can do that.
Yeah.
Really quick one, just to get out of the way. Can I purchase your teaching material or record a video after the camp if I wasn't able to join you guys on time?
Yes, but you shouldn't.
I was about to, yeah, but you're missing out a whole lot of stuff. Like what we said before, one of the key things is that you can actually get the feedback and stuff in the community. You can join a little later. You'll miss something, but you still get the people. So I would advise, like if you're missing the first 4 out of the 12 weeks, that you join in after 4 weeks rather than waiting the whole 12 weeks and then joining, because then you just miss all the community. And you just get less value for money. Even though the value will still be pretty good, it'll be less. But I am planning to put little snippets of core information that I think is super useful for everyone up anyway, and maybe on a Gumroad or something that people can buy. So if they don't want to invest or kind of want to have a sample, that they can get that. But the whole feedback and community is what you're doing it for. So. All right, next questions. If I remember correctly, in Noah's first two art camps, there was a tier system to the homework, easy, insane, or something. Is it going to be the same way with your work, or is the homework set? No, I'll have the same. I have this like list of stuff that you need to do, and then I'll mark down a few things which are really important, and the rest is different. The homework scales differently because I have three games, three different difficulties. So how difficult you want to make it yourself is dependent on the game that you pick.
That's a good way to do it.
Yeah. I'm like all about innovation. So the games will be pretty interesting. I think they're interesting. I'm not going to reveal them because I'm just kind of like that. I've tried and tested them on a few people, and I've been told they're nice and representative, so there should be something in there for everyone. One of the awful things about being a concept artist is that if you've worked on the same project for a year, you know it so well, and you're so tired of the IP, or you can get so tired of the IP, and you still have to go with it. And what I would love, this sounds so cruel to say, but what I would love is that people in, like, you know, week two or three, when they pick their projects, they go like, this is amazing. And then by week seven or eight, they're going, oh, this is so stupid. This is hard. because again, better to have that awful experience right now and know how to deal with it than get it in the studio and get frustrated and just kind of like mess everything up. You just try to make as much mistakes and get as much frustration out of the way in the safe bubble of learning environment where you won't lose your job than to completely have a breakdown, like a meltdown in the studio. I've seen it happen.
Yeah.
I need like a water break. Do you need a water break?
It's a lot of talking. Water break.
Mm-hmm. Hydration is important. It's very important. Mm. That's not going to be covered in the course. That's a freebie. Hydrate.
How to drink enough water.
How to drink enough water. For sure. Oh, I like this one because it starts friendly. I haven't even read the question, but it says, hello, Titus and Noah. I said, hello. Hello.
So very proper.
Very proper. I like that. How are you? I'd like to ask if whether the style of painting really matters in the field of concept arts. A lot of guys paint photorealistically, and a lot of other guys are using this painterly style. Which one is best for concept design? Which bear is best? Black bear or brown bear? That is to say that it doesn't really matter a whole lot. The Guild Wars stuff, amazing, super illustrative, it's gorgeous. It kind of does, so some of the concept stages will be very project specific. Thank you very much. The woman behind the screen making all of this possible. I can do the insane hours and shield just to keep me afoot. Sometimes some stuff will get a request to be very realistic because people need to model from it. But there is this position in concept art where you can get to where you're a little bit more established because of your style, and then it doesn't really matter at all. Like they hire you not only for your rendering but also for your vision, and if your vision is exactly what they need for the project, they could not care less on how you do it, not on the technical level and not on the outcome. I think illustration has a lot, just is like that times 100, right? They care about how does it feel.
Yeah, I mean, if they're hiring you, they want what you do. And if anyone comes to me and they want to hire me for something I do not do, I'm usually just profoundly confused because illustration is built around this guy does this thing that looks like this. And if you suddenly come to me and you're like, I want this, you know, animated style, like 2D happy painting, I'm not your guy. I am not. And I've told many people that. I'm like, this sounds really cool, but this is nothing like what I do.
Yeah.
You should really find a better artist for this. I have no shame in turning away work like that. Some people maybe are more diverse than I am and are happy to branch out and do all sorts of crazy things, but sometimes things go a little too far for me.
Yeah. I've had the question before as well. Like they people were like, could you paint this? But then in like Craig Mullins was like, wouldn't that be a treat?
It's like, yeah, sure, I'd love to.
That'd be pretty good. Actually, the only thing holding me back from reaching that kind of quality is your $200 that you want to pay me. You never thought of it that way, but yeah, let's do that. Don't really work that way. Cinti Companion or Microsoft Surface is what Ursula asks.
I have
a Companion. Noah has the other one, the Surface. Like we established, we spent so much time talking about this when I was deciding what to get because Noah had the Surface, and I was like, oh, I don't know what to get. If you are used to drawing on a Cintiq, the Companion is pretty good. The number two is pretty good as well, less problems. If you've never painted on a Companion or on a Cintiq, it doesn't matter what you choose. Zero difference.
I think that's true. Because once people get so used to the Cintiq line and having everything feel the same, then there's a certain draw to that because they want that same feel. I didn't really have that experience with Cintiqs. I never actually technically owned a Cintiq. So switching over to the Surface for me is really easy. I really like the Surface. I'll probably buy a Surface 4 whenever they come out. And I'll probably buy another Cintiq at some point. I'm not beholden to one or the other. I just need to like have both at the same time.
Two hand ambidextrous painting. Well, you wouldn't have that. You need a hand for the shortcuts. I'm sorry. You need paint without using shortcuts.
Cannot paint with.
If I see people paint without using their keyboards, I get really angry. Don't let me see you do that. Quick question in between.
Yeah.
Where do we post the stuff to get a review / overpaints on the Facebook event page? And I'll get back to overpaints actually right now. I'm going to try answer questions and talk about this stuff at the same time. This image, I forgot to post this. Greg posted this one. This is a really cool angle. At the same time, this is a really difficult kind of angle where you're just nailing the three-point perspective. And the only thing that I can comment really quick on this, one of the things that strikes me very much is this tree in the background, which is it's forming this weird parallel-like tangent with the arm. It doesn't sit very well with the balloon, and it has almost the same value as the tree in the foreground. So I would say knock this guy back or get rid of it. You don't really need the detail. Same for right here. The detail right in there is not sitting really nicely with the arm. Kind of like crunches it. Things need room to breathe, right? This needs room to breathe. This arm needs room. So this tree, either remove it or knock it back.
Yep. I agree.
Lightning speed. Next by Errol. And this is something that I instantly see. First of all, cool image. Very thick fog in here. Very thick. That's pretty awesome. See, this is good because this kind of got that dynamic going on. There's the angle. Things have enough space. Actually, I would argue that here you can cut stuff up with a diagonal. Or at least something, because things are feeling a little empty.
Yeah.
And then perspective. It's being a little weird. These repetitive shapes are always difficult because our brain does a lot with pattern recognition. 7, 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. It's a weird rhythm for us because we're actually expecting something a little bit more chaotic or something to be mirrored on the other side. With architecture. So this is when you're drawing like a little building tower thing. You have these things at the bottom. They are actually quite difficult because you will notice super fast when they're not right because we're so used to seeing these kind of rhythms and shapes. So whenever you feel like a building's not sitting very well, it might be that the patterns that you're using or the rhythm that you're creating in there is kind of weird. And at the same time, the rhythm here is leading you in a weird way because we're going up here to the top, and then we're being, you know, let down and then kind of carried out. So make sure you check that that flow. Let's see. I think I already got someone from this guy. Ooh, here we go. This one's by Katie Grissom. Hey, Katie, I remember. Katie was a student in one of my courses, which was awesome. And I see that a lot that we talked about is actually in here with the nice flow lines and stuff back and forth, left to right. That's pretty good. But I think maybe we're a little...
Too dark.
We're pretty dark.
Too dark.
We're pretty dark.
Too many blacks. So dark.
Histogram.
It's like a bright light filled thing. It's so dark.
Yeah. The silhouetting is cool. The composition is cool. Like the wing is actually doing a lot for us, but it is...
Yeah.
It's too dark for us to see anything.
So dark.
Also, these rocks are getting a little over-designed. You can simplify. If you go like, look, this is the focal point. Put all your detail in here. Don't really worry about any of the detail outside of it. Don't really matter. We're not going to look there anyway. You're already directing us here, so why actually spend any form of attention at all on this kind of stuff? Right? It's irrelevant. People, if you are posting portfolios, it will take me longer actually to look at it because I have to load your website and stuff. So please only post pictures because it's quicker and you have a better chance of me actually seeing and reviewing the stuff. All right, this is by Jack Jones. He says, it's pretty awesome you guys are doing this. And first off, I'd like to agree.
I think we're pretty awesome.
There's a hidden week 13 of the art camp in which we teach everyone to have a gigantic ego. It's hilarious.
I think we should make that midweek zero. Ego first. So before anything gets started, they're already full of themselves. Don't know anything. Super full of themselves. Basically know as a student.
But this one's actually funny because I would say you're not going dark enough.
Yeah.
I would say if you focus the light and have a gradient, we'll pull in more. Remember, we're seeing gradients dark to light. So this will actually mean that we have this cool, oh, this is a grayscale image, wonderful. Imagine this being orange that pulls you that way. So I would say gradients. This is a really cool setup, though. It's nice.
Yeah, I really like the lighting setup there.
Maybe again, give a little bit more room on all the sides for it to breathe a little bit.
Yeah, the hand feels a little too like cramped. It feels like she's got like a tiny hand or tiny arm or something like that. It feels
like
kind of
weird,
creepy. Yeah, it feels like it's kind of growing out the neck or something like that. Which is a little weird.
Maybe it is. I don't know.
Maybe totally misreading the composition.
We could not be getting this at all, man. For sure. Let me just get through another question that is upvoted 7 and 8 times. Jeez, really want these answered. And here we go. For Titus, do you actually draw all the details? I like it. Do you even? Or is it made from photos? Because I've seen some far too good. Wow, thank you.
Yeah, you're good. Stop hiring people with that.
I like these people. These are good. It highly depends. Most of the stuff will have photo textures in them. Absolutely. Actually, funnily enough, some of the lunch sketches are actually completely painted. And some of them are completely photo bashed. I have no idea which ones you're talking about, so I can't really answer. But the trick is to make stuff look organic and to put the detail where your eye is focusing on. And if you can do that quicker by photos, do it. If the whole piece is painted, maybe not do it in photos because the contrast will be pretty high. And that's it. Actually, if I open... I'm opening a PSD and it might take a while because it is actually, it's actually already opened. It's the big ziggurat painting that I did as the promo piece for this art camp, which I painted fairly hugely. So there's a full breakdown on how I make this image from thumbnail to finish. And some of the details in here are definitely photos, right? This is getting pretty detailed. Some of this are definitely photos, but the others is just clever compression. So what you do is you grab a piece like this, and then you blow it up even bigger, you paint it, and then you shrink it back down again. And then you get this insane amount of detail. And the only thing you actually then need to know about is what makes things detailed look photorealistic, in which, in most cases, it's a very high detail density, right? Yeah. So it's kind of funny because this piece over here was part of a photo, right? Whereas the same piece on the other side is actually just mostly painted. But when zoomed out, they feel really similar. So that's just all knowing about your deal aspect ratio, which is also fairly covered in the thing. There's a little water breaking. This one's for Noah. While I hydrate. Oh. What social media or art sites do you recommend for establishing yourself? I know Noah is on about 20 or more.
Yeah, I am. Honestly, it doesn't take a lot of time to put your stuff everywhere. So if you're just trying to establish yourself, go ahead and put it friggin' everywhere. You know, down the road, eventually you'll probably realize what works well for you and what doesn't. Certain styles, moods, subject matters appeal to certain things more. Like Tumblr. Tumblr has a certain feel to it that Tumblr likes, and Tumblr only likes that. So find what works best for you, I guess, would be the thing. And screw Facebook, because I hate Facebook, but that's just my bitter opinion on it.
Facebook has a funny way of changing their algorithms all the time, which you're not seeing most of people's work.
It's incredibly frustrating to have like years and years of effort and like, you know, 25,000 likes on a page and like get like 20 likes on a painting, like a painting.
Because no one actually gets to see it. It's weird.
Yeah, I'm doing, you know, better work supposedly than I used to do, but getting, you know, a fraction of the attention. So.
So in the short, what do we recommend? Pretty much like we talked about before, all of them, and then progressively less and less.
Yeah.
I'll do this review really quick. this is a pretty good painting. Like, I would say
the colors
are awesome. The contrast between the high saturation and low saturation is just super. I will say that this is a stronger painting, like this nice center composition, because there's all these lines, but they're not really going anywhere.
Yeah.
So if you make them go someplace, it is awesome. You have all the makings here for an awesome piece. You just kind of need to have that extra story element, right? Because if we wonder
how much is that black bar bothering you at the bottom? Is that bothering you?
No, is it? I don't know. It's maybe bothering me because it's a little uniform, right? Because it's too much of a straight line. Why does it keep doing that? Yeah. Again, diagonals would help. I like the blur on it, though. Camera depth. You guys can play around with the camera depth a lot if you want, by the way. It's totally cool. So many images. Someone say, I really hate this piece. I hope it gets reviewed.
Sweet.
No problem, sir. Yeah, first off, this is annoying because it's a pretty one-way conversation. We can ask, why do you hate it? And then he can never answer.
Nice. I love one-way conversations.
Yeah, so I'm not sure. I think this is good. You got a nice strong triangle composition going on here, which is good. Triangle compositions are nice and powerful. You make no mistake that you want to go outside of this triangle by getting anything else. It's a comfortable way of reading this image and then exiting again. So I don't know. Like,
I think a little brushing up on the three-point perspective could be good. It looks a little bit like straight on the character. It looks like the whole thing, we're looking at it straight on. I think you could do maybe a little bit more looking up at.
This is like
a little off there.
It feels this guy has his horizon right here.
Yeah, exactly.
And the rest is
whereas
here.
We're supposed to be looking up at it. So
yeah,
I checked that out. And then the faces look a little off to me, at least the thumbnail size. So they just look a little detached from the rest of the piece. But
yeah.
Make it.
Like, you could get some reference for this and paint it, but don't forget that if you have a piece which is overall high quality, like a lot of things are going right, the smallest thing that's not going right could just completely distort your view of it, and then it becomes hard to find. You go like, man, this piece, like, it has all the elements, but why does it feel weird? And it could be something super tiny, like this face might be throwing you off and then throwing the whole piece off, or this hairline, you know? It could be really weird stuff. Like that. But I think, like Noah said, the three-point perspective on this character, this being a little bit too face-on, could actually be one of the major culprits here. Let's see. Moving on, we have I think this person knows what we're going to say about this one. They were tuning in before. Alex?
They're black.
Oh, Alex, if only you had time to quickly fix it before we got to it. It is pretty black. However, it's not too bad with the floor.
It's not as bad as like other offenders.
No,
sure.
But the contrast is extreme. So one of the things, again, like we're saying, is that contrast or gradients help us flow through an image. And if you go from these extreme super darks to super light in such a short span relatively on the painting, you're kind of eliminating that possibility for gradients. And it's in these gradients in the mid-tones that we get to see a lot of the interesting details happening and how they're reacting to light. So when people are impressed with, the lighting looks good, what they mean is that the lighting in the mid-tones looks really realistic, because the shadows and highlights are kind of, you can fudge that a lot. What you can't really fudge is the lighting in the midtones, because people see that because their eye moves over them so much. So that midtones, man.
The more I paint, the more I love like that midtone value range, keeping it like really tight in that. I love it. I used to hate it when I was starting out, but
this is
now
difficult.
I love it.
It's so different. Yeah. Getting the mid-tones, I hate painting mid-tones, but actually it's all I do now, because I know that I can't fuck it up. All right, we got a plus nine.
Ooh.
Plus nine on the questions. Hey, Titus, that's me. A question more for you, but how do you see the blending of 3D and concept art going in the industry? It seems like more and more the lines get blurred between the two, and it would help you get further if you know a little 3D as a concept art. So, two parts of that: knowing how to use the program yourself, and the other is understanding how it works for games. The latter you definitely need. The more you're able to communicate with the team and to make concept catered on the restrictions of the engine and so forth, the better you can do your job. First one, it seems that is going to be the new kind of hot topic. You have the pro 3D and the anti or not, I don't know if anti, but not pro 3D people. The one is convinced that that's where the industry is going. You cannot go without. The other is saying you can't. I'm on the side that says you can go without 3D. Knowing it could be nice, especially for hard surface modelers, creating kind of quick things and tanks and vehicles, posing them. That's pretty useful. But for environments, I've never actually had the need to do it. So there's that. And at the same time, I think Noah might have disconnected. Yep, Noah's gone. That's okay. There's no more noise in my ear, but I'm sure he'll join in a sec anyway. 3D from that kind of a point of view, it would be good to know. The more you know about it, the better. But definitely, you don't have to be this 3D kind of guru to make it as a concept artist at all. So, done. And you're back. Yay! Nice. All right. We have another one by Peter Parkinson. Would you recommend using other mediums such as painting, oils, water, watercolors, or 3D making in order to progress better digitally in terms of composition and planning for environment or character design? In terms of getting better at composition, no. But understanding what it is that you want to do, yeah. Like how paint works and how, you know, what can you do with it? What looks good?
Yeah. I think there is some merit to trying out all the different things because you can pick up different ways of thinking. Obviously, for watercolors or oils or anything like that, you'd have to approach image making a little differently than you would straight up digitally. And I think having those different approaches sort of in your toolbox is a good thing. So I'd say it's generally good though.
Absolutely. There you go. Do as much things as you can. We'll go back to the screen sharing again. let's say this is Tom Liang saying he did this for another group character challenge. The topic was to design a Game of Thrones character and choose, and he chose the Night's Watch for his second attempt and made a non-human guard. He really wants to know if you did okay or bad. I don't know why you would do bad. I mean, if you're basing that on how many likes you get on Facebook, that don't do that, ever.
That is a terrible, terrible thing to do.
Terrible thing to do in a slippery slope. I like it. I think this has a lot of cool design elements in it for sure. The only thing that I'm wondering from my concept point of view, and again, for illustration or you know, very established IPs, it doesn't matter. But how does he wield this sword and the lamp at the same time, right? Does he like put one down, or does he shine it? Does he just wield the thing with one hand and uses like the lamp as a shield? I don't know. It seems pretty interesting. But this would be.
This is why you're a concept artist and not an illustrator.
I know.
You're an illustrator, right? You're like, oh yeah, that looks cool. It looks cool. That means it's good. Right.
This is a topic we actually discuss in depth called the gamification. So how much realism does the game design forego in order to sell the concept, you know? Think about the double jump, the triple jump. That's not really real. That's super gamification. But in that universe, it might make total sense. It's saying that in movies, silencers actually completely silence gunshots, which is hilarious, but we'll just accept it because, fine, it's movies. So that's the only thing. This is not like a illustration or any kind of issue. The only thing that this would be is a gamification issue. And if your project says, no, you can do that, then, you know, fine. There's nothing wrong with it. I like it. I think it's pretty good. Do you got any tips? Maybe the foot. The foot's a little weird. Feet are weird, but the foot is a little weird.
Yeah. I mean, as far as characters go, heads and hands are, like, super important. And so, like, the hand holding the lantern's actually pretty good, but the hand holding the sword is a little awkward and weird.
Because
I'd work on that.
Kind of misaligned.
Yeah, it's not quite like lining up there. So I'd say to work on that because everyone looks at them, and if you don't do them well, everyone will notice. So
absolutely. But to answer your question, dude, did you do bad? No, of course not. You didn't do bad. Didn't get enough likes. That's their problem. Come on.
Well, if it makes you feel better, no one did not get enough likes either. So.
All right, this one is by Sam White. Yeah, by Sam White. Yay. And he says, Titus, you the best. Well, I think Noah should be included in that as well.
I think we are both the best.
We're both equally awesome as everyone else at the same time as well. Is this a centaur? This is a centaur, isn't it? Nice. Nice. Banner centaur. This is a completely new spin on our wandering stick salesman. That's awesome.
Now it's wandering centaurs.
Wandering centaurs. I'm glad that that's a thing. In terms of composition, this what you're doing right here, that's really good. That's nice. Yeah, I like that. Feels good. Yeah, feels very nice. The only thing which I can say, like, I'm sorry that I have to go through these so fast, guys. I wish I could give like more feedback. I know that maybe some of you were expecting very in-depth feedback, but there's so much to cover. So I hope you don't mind that I'm kind of like doing the essential quick call-outs on these ones. When we do the art camp one, the 2-hour, it will be a lot more in-depth, but I won't cover as many images, obviously. But anyway, there you have it. One thing I'll say about this is that there's a way you render rocks in here and you render the tree in the same way. It's kind of distracting because it makes the tree look like a giant rock. And because I read this right half as a rock, this left half doesn't make sense to me. Because this is not what rocks look like. And then when I read it the other way around, when I read it left to right and go like, oh yeah, this is a tree, and then the right side doesn't make sense to me because it looks like a rock.
Yeah, I think the other thing that I was saying was that it's sort of flattening out in a lot of places because the edges of the forms don't really recede. The edge of the form and the foreground and the edge of the form for the tree, they don't really recede. There's just sort of like cut off, like someone just took an eraser tool to the edge of it and they just sort of like stop. And those edges are super important for actually getting like some form to it. So you have to like think about how it actually like wraps around and how perspective works. And this is why Titus will constantly rant about perspective.
Yes. This is the thing that drove people insane in studios where I worked, where they looked at an image and go like, oh, isn't this cool? And the first thing I'd say, perspective's wrong. Yeah, but the image is cool. Yeah, sure, whatever. But the perspective is wrong. So what do you want me to say? So this is like, if this would be like a 3D mesh, right? How would it go? Where would the compression be? And in all these areas where you have compression, especially because this tree is wrapping around, these edges would do completely different things than what's happening more in the middle right here, right? So that's a good point that Noah made about that. Think about the volumes and stuff. Shit wraps around. You're wrapping, you know? All right. We get, well, this is a lot of atmospheric perspective from Mr. Daniel. I just put like half a cup of water on myself. Oh, no, it's actually not that bad. But I did spill water. Commercial break. all right, cool. So this is a pretty intense color change, but I like it. I like this color shift.
I like it.
It is cool.
I love the colors. Yeah.
It is it's pretty awesome. Two things. These characters down here, I just noticed them just now.
Yeah, I noticed them because there's an orange circle around them.
They kind of fall outside of the composition. And it's actually because the light focuses us right here, and then this space is actually pointing there as well, which means every time you have two or more lines pointing at it, you can kind of bet that everything between those pointing lines is being cut off. We're saying this is not relevant or interesting. Right, and this is exactly where those characters are. So poor characters are lost. They're lost in the composition. Now, that doesn't mean you have to put them smack in the middle here, because that would be a little bit of a cliche, but it means that these characters then start to communicate with these shapes over here, right? And this could be its own thing. This line could be its completely own thing, doing whatever, but then this whole section needs to really sit well with these guys in order to emphasize them, because you don't need these rocks and these lines to emphasize this light ray, because it is just, it is super strong. And maybe make this, I mean, if there is actually a sun right behind it, this would be dark, so dark.
Yeah,
would not receive enough bounce light to stay light and bright. Let's see. This is on a art station thing, and I'll wait for it to load because it's being slow. Meanwhile, we go to a painting from what sounds like one of my countrymen. Giel, that's how you say that in Dutch. Let's see. Hi, Titus and Noah. I think this is my best landscape painting in my portfolio. I like the composition and colors, but feel that in some areas the paint was moved around too much, so it lost that loose feeling to it. I was wondering what I could have done differently, and I'm curious about your thoughts on it. All Noah, thoughts?
This is usually the place in more thumbnail, because I don't actually think there's much issue with the colors. I don't think there's too much issue with the lighting. I think there's mainly issues just with how the composition's laid out that makes it feel kind of awkward. Like that space on the left is super, super, super awkward. That whole like left chunk of the painting. That's another case of if you cut that out, you'd have a stronger painting. I'd say to just think about composition.
I know that these branches will probably point at the thing and that they're meant to be pointing, but they're not feeling very subtle because these are almost the same value, right? So we read them as being on exactly the same plane, making this tree ridiculously huge or this house incredibly small. So that's
the also thing. If that's the sun, that is going to be super bright, and if that's the moon, it's still going to be super bright.
You're going to have like insane shadowing coming from all of this stuff, like,
and tons of bloom, always bloom. Everything has bloom.
So I think moving the paint around a bit too much might be happening because you go like, well, I don't know, do I need to fix this? You're trying to, usually what happens when people go into this kind of over-rendering is because they're trying to fix something, but they don't really know what they're trying to fix, right? So you just keep painting in the hopes that it'll go away. And what you actually need to do is you need to take a step back, like really far, literally, and just have a look and what's going wrong. And again, by doing the thumbnails in this kind of way, by starting off with this kind of stuff, you will avoid that. You'll cure that completely.
I think it's one of the big lessons I've learned from working on like Magic and other card games is always make your paintings read when they're, you know, 2 inches across. You know, if a painting read 2 inches across, then you're probably good. If it doesn't, you might want to look into that.
Let's see, there is a question which is pretty important, so I'll keep this image up. It says, I see people can sign up for a bundle art camp including Noah's number 1 and 2. How does this work? Do they run simultaneously or one after another?
They do not run at all. Titus's course is active, it is instructed, there is critiques, it is currently running my stuff, it's just sort of legacy stuff. You can get all the downloads, watch all the stuff, watch all the critiques, but there is no active instruction. There are no teachers to it. It is not actively running. So, it's just sort of if you want 50 hours of extra videos, you can get all of that. So.
Okay, there you have it. Moving on to this painting, which is done by Mert. Thank you for sending that in, Mert. What do we think about this painting?
It's headed in the right direction.
For sure. I think this tight value range is pretty cool. This is a really funky time of day, which is awesome.
Yeah, I really like the values.
I'll break this down in terms of super abstract. This is something that I'll explain further along. What I see happening here. Whoops. We have two very strong horizontals versus one strong vertical. And if our painting feels empty, we might want to introduce a strong vertical right here, because then you'll mirror these two. This doesn't mean that you have to put a tower here. I mean, this could be a cloud break or actually just some nicely placed brush marks. Sid Mead does this a lot. When you look at some Sid Mead backgrounds, you'll see him painting a very loose, so grab like a big loose brush and he'll do this kind of stuff, right? Yeah. What this does is this painting direction will actually then reinforce whatever is going on down here. He's looking for verticals or diagonals, and that's kind of another way of approaching your painting, and it will make it feel more dynamic in that way. So that simplification will help you out kind of a lot when you're struggling, like, oh man, how do I make this more interesting? Well, check your horizontals and verticals. What's going on?
Yeah. Also, if it was me, I would just bump that character over slightly until it was perfectly centered, but that's just me.
Yeah, that might be a good one.
I don't like slightly off-centered compositions. It bothers me.
I love them.
People are like so scared of centering things. I'm like, just put it in the middle. There's nothing wrong with the middle of the painting.
That's the thing. With the middle one, in illustration, you can definitely do that, no problem. In concept, usually people looking at concept want to see something dynamic, and when you center things, like with the strict formal composition, achieving this is so hard. You need to be so good at what you're doing that I would just kind of like advise against it, because it's just a headache, man. It's just a headache. I don't know how you do it. It's just a headache.
Just put everything in the middle.
Sent in by Jeffrey. Am I saying that right? I think this is sent in by Jeffrey. Let me click the thing again. Yes, by Jeffrey Chang. Thought I'd submit one too. Well, thank you very much, Jeffrey, for submitting one as well. Talking about center compositions. There you go.
Nice.
We
got centered in the middle.
Well, these guidelines, they certainly work. Issue, though, you are focusing everything here with these cool directions, but I'm getting too distracted by the fact that this is incredibly light.
Yeah.
These tools that you're using are quite subtle, and the eye chooses contrast over subtlety. So we're looking at the top here before we look at the door, which is not good. Actually, we're not moving down to the door. I can see that we're supposed to go there, but this top half is too bright, and it's preventing us from doing that. I think, yeah.
I can see it.
Get the nice, like,
I mean, I kind of head shape. See it. If you want the focal point to be the top, like, it could work, but yeah. I don't know. Yeah
absolutely. Oh, we need to get to... I need to get the questions again. Wow, plus 13. I mean, these questions are getting upvoted higher and higher. Insane. Quick one. Do you prefer in-house or continue to freelancing? And why? Ask by Mert.
Freelancing.
Pros and cons. Freelancing. Your own hours. Love it. Downside, your own hours tend to get really, really long.
True.
Erratic work patterns. Not good. In-house, social environment, working with other people. Pretty nice. Social interaction is good.
Working with other people.
Downside, you're working with other people. Not I've done both for like 2.5 years. It's actually pretty even. I can't decide. I have no idea. When I work in a studio for too long, I kind of get claustrophobic. You're like, oh, I want to go freelance. And then when I freelance, I'm like, in the beginning, this is amazing. I have my own time. And then after a few months, I'm like, I'm so lonely. I have no one to talk to. I have no structure. I'm working 14 hours a day. I want to, someone please give me this 9-to-5. If it's a fun studio with fun people, and studio work is awesome. If you have a wonderful client that pays you lots of money to sit at home and freelance, then freelance sounds pretty good as well.
Yeah.
I don't know. If you're not social, and if you have terrible body hygiene, please freelance. Do all of us a favor. You know it.
What I've known for.
Let's see. Oh, plus 12. Not as plus 13, but I mean, if I gave it a minute. Is there a major advantage to concept artist versus illustrator in terms of commercial viability / income?
Yeah. At least, well, I think. I don't know. Well, I've heard some rates. Sadly low.
In terms of
so
rates,
maybe not.
You can't beat freelancing. In terms of rates, there is no way you can beat freelancing. There's not. Upside of working in-house is you get healthcare, you get pension, you get sick days, you get like all the social side is just taken care of. You don't have to deal with annoying clients, just maybe an annoying boss, but you'll try, you know, none of that. They're both really unstable. You could be like on the top of the world with illustration and then get nothing for no good reason.
Yep.
And you could be on your way to make an awesome concept and they go like, you know what, we're downsizing. You're no longer necessary. And a concept is really sensitive to that because there's only a few in-house and they go like, well, we can just hire a guy, you know, for freelance.
Yeah.
I think it's about even. There's definitely, so I think the split is less money in concept art. If you only do in-house, it's really difficult to rival illustration freelance. Because there's no limit. You're not stuck to like inflation rates and salary cap and that kind of stuff. Yeah. But the social security side of it is much, much bigger and greater. And all of the stuff is just kind of taken care of. Yeah. You'd like tick a box. You want a pension? You want health care? Oh, yeah. Want a masseuse on Tuesday? Oh, yeah. That's all they have. Do it.
Yeah, illustrators don't get any of that.
All right. Done. Let me just check real quick how many more submissions we got. Actually, we're doing pretty good in submissions. So I'm doing I'm going through them more. Look, now it's center composition.
Wow. Put in the middle.
Ryan Richmond. Ryan and the central composition. What do you think? Is this a good way of doing the central comp?
Yeah. There's only a couple things that I find weird.
Really?
Again, things reading is super important. One of the most important things about things reading, silhouette. That thing sitting in his right hand, I know it's a shield. It doesn't look like a shield at all. No one ever looks at a shield from side on, so that's going to drive me insane. That's totally going to drive me insane.
Maybe something more like that.
Just like that. Just a little bit more.
You know what I see?
Yeah.
Those are great.
Triangles.
But we know we don't need this guy. We don't need him.
Take them out.
He's breaking this awesome guy's silhouette. He's breaking this silhouette. I can't. I go like,
Get it out of there. Ah, see how much it reads now?
And he reads. And even, because this is a helm, you could even go like, look.
Yep, you could break it. Yeah.
Look. Oh, yeah. Look, I'm going super white now. There you go.
Oh, yeah.
Boom. See, you don't need all the elements. You had two very strong ones in there, which were awesome, and you were done. These ones actually do help. These help frame it, which is good.
Yeah, I'm okay with those.
Yeah, we're okay with those. That's nice. Awesome. Good one.
Yeah, I like it.
Getting a lot more characters than I was expecting. It's kind of throwing me off a little bit.
Yeah, I know. It's like, let's send our character work to the environment, guys.
I get that so much, and it makes me so nervous. I'm like, oh, what the fuck is going on?
I don't know what to say.
Oh, no. It's good. Everything's good. this was sent by Naomi. A quick environment piece I'd love feedback on before polishing it up. But cool. That's good that you noticed that we're not like going to complain about polishing. Like Noah said before about the edges and volume, I think this little guy in here is suffering from that. These edges in here as well. I mean, they're better. They're definitely better. That's good.
Yeah.
Noise on this edge is the same as the noise on this edge. Probably don't want to do that. Yeah. If you don't do that, there's more depth. This is a nice way of rendering.
Perspective could be a little tighter on things, just in general.
Yeah.
I think I would just chuck down a grid if you didn't already, just to make things a little easier. On yourself, because I think it could be a little bit stronger. Like there's some wonkiness, like with how high the trees are and stuff, that's feeling a little off.
The values in here, you have a light side here and a dark side in here, which I would again advise against, because we're drawn to this lighter portion in there, or actually need to be looking somewhere more over there, right? So this left side right here feels like it's its own painting. And actually, it could be its own painting. It could be a very, let's see if we do it like, just guessing here, but it's something like, yeah, see, that's a pretty good frame right there.
Like a little character down in there, and you're good.
Yeah, you could probably just move the characters from one end to the other. So make sure that things are pointing kind of in the right direction. There's so much going right in this image, like the way these trees are being rendered up here. That's super lovely. I like that. The general, like the tone of the image based on the lighting and the values is really nice. It's very pleasant to look at. So make sure you point everything in the right direction so people know where to look. Right, knowing where to look is important. So let's see. Cody has posted a number of images. All right. I just want to say, I saw this image. I just want to show it to people. This is done by Cody Hogg. And I just wanted to say that this is really cool.
That's traditional?
Yeah, it looks like it. And I have zero comments on this.
I am not that good, so I'm going to keep my mouth shut.
I will just say this is awesome. Cody is obviously very good. At that kind of stuff. I accidentally closed the page. No. I wanted to close the image, but... oh, man. No, how many more paintings? I thought I was getting there. So many new paintings popped up.
You're never done.
Oh, no. hang on, guys. I'm scrolling. Hang on. Okay, there's a lot more. Holy cow, there are a lot more. Oh man, I thought I was almost done. There's like 15 more.
Did we suddenly get popular? Some part of the world wake up.
I don't know. What I will say, I won't show it in here. You can see it on the event page. Cody does some digital work as well, which is showing the same design skills, but a little less refinement in how it's rendered. And the only thing I can say to that is just stick with the rendering. Learn more about the rendering, and then everything will work out fine. Because when you're at that kind of skill level, there's nothing that on that side, on such a quick kind of review that I can say that will make a difference. For example, on this one, posted by Titus with an A. Nice, close, love it. That things are flat, everything's stacked.
Yeah, don't be scared of perspective.
Yep. Don't be. You know what I sometimes do with this kind of stuff? Have it. Copy it, paste it, distort. Boom.
Boom. Look at that. Depth.
And you got some depth going.
That's free depth.
Free depth. And another thing that's going on, the same with this framework that's going on in here. This feels very 2D. It's all very kind of flat. So trying to make sure you get some sort of perspective angle in, and one way of doing this is actually just making a very quick like perspective drawing of the shape that you want to do, and you can change like the vanishing point on it, so you can kind of mess around like how far do you want that angle to be. Do you want it to be straight on like it is now, or do you want it to be very far on the side, you know, that you only have a very short angle here and a long angle on that side, and that will create some more interest, you know. See, that'll be, this is already quite dynamic. So look for that kind of stuff. Look to make it quite dynamic, because these images are all cool, like architectures within giant structure. So cool. That's always the best.
Always cool.
That's always cool. Would love to get some feedback on this one. Wow, this is elaborate. Whew. What a break.
Whoa, that looks cool.
Tight value control, awesome.
The tree on the left.
The tree on the left?
Yeah, I don't like it.
So is the trees.
That's the only thing I don't like. Everything else is great.
Yeah, everything else works. I would say that the values in this character are a little too close. I would love to see a little bit more.
Yeah.
Light and dark information going on, because that just makes it look more 3D. So this is all mid-tone, and maybe push some values more to like another tool. Let's see. I'll do this one and then I'll do a few more questions because we are running out of time. Now, I don't mind going a little bit longer. All right, let's see. This is done by Mikhail Grigley. Wait, did we review some of your work before? I don't know. It doesn't matter. So, this is pretty sweet. Values are cool. Composition is cool.
Mood's great.
I know that we're supposed to be looking here. But this line is carrying us out. And we need something in here to keep us here, like a colored banner.
Some torches.
Or some torches down here would do the trick. Anything to kind of catch our attention. And that could be in either in contrast or design. Doesn't really matter. So to keep you
in. Also, some scale birds. Nice silhouette there on the sky.
Oh, yeah. Some birds right here. Some of these houses could have some lights on or still burning. Yeah. Anything to kind of break up the color in this one a little bit would be great.
Yeah.
That would really be nice. Good. It's a good. All right. Let's turn this off and get back to the questions. Leisha plus 9 voted says, good morning. Good morning.
Indeed. So happy. So positive.
Or good afternoon. I think we have people from all over the world here. All right. Question by Alexander. What job opportunities are you aware of for freelance concept artists / industrial designers in Europe? I'm asking this because I'm interested in moving to Europe after I finish my honors in industrial design. In pure industrial design? I don't really know. For freelancing, it doesn't matter where you are, because you're freelancing. It doesn't matter. The density of game studios in Europe is pretty high, but it's just spread over a lot of different countries. I like Europe. I'm from there. I think it's pretty awesome. Beautiful, beautiful towns. As far as actual industrial design goes, I don't know. Luckily, a lot of countries here are sponsoring game development right now. So that means that a lot of indie studios are actually coming up. That means that a lot of work is being done. I know some companies are actively hiring specialists because of that as well. So architects and industrial designers are getting super popular. So I wouldn't be surprised. But to be fair, the job market anywhere is difficult for concept artists. That's the best I can make of it. It's just difficult and kind of sucky everywhere you go. So if you like Europe, just go to Europe.
Don't come to New Zealand to get
studios. Sorry. Yeah, don't go to New Zealand.
Or Australia. Just avoid this part of the world.
But do go there if you can just to see it.
Yeah, definitely come here, but don't come here to work.
All right, let's see. Andrew asks, many of us have most studied illustration than industrial design. What is your background and how do you deal with functionality and the other things, especially specific to this field, without being in a school like the Art Center and become as good? First of all, I don't know if I'm as good.
What do you do when you're not as good at Art Center?
get better? Follow art camps and get better.
Yeah, take the scores.
it's difficult. So I did 3 years of art school and 4 years of game design school. Most of those 7 years were a waste, save for maybe a year and a half of combined knowledge. And getting the information that you need is now no longer bound to any school. It's mostly bound to how motivated you are and keeping yourself motivated enough to gather all that information in an efficient way is actually the most difficult thing. It's not finding it, it's self-motivation to actually do it in a proper way. As for how do I tackle things if I don't know them, I'll either ask people that I know are skilled in it, or I try to read and study up on it. So concept art is not the profession you can do when you're stupid. There's a lot of thinking involved. That's it. And I assume everyone here is actually not stupid. This is a assumption I'm making, and I think that none of you are actually stupid. That means...
That is a bold assumption.
But that means you can solve problems yourself. This is one of the things that I'm such a huge fan of is saying that once you know how to identify and tackle problems, there's nothing that's going to be in your way. I mean, there's a time constraint, how fast you're going to learn stuff. I was actually thinking of naming this art camp, how to not be an idiot. Because that's actually all it takes. Not being an idiot, then you can be a good concept artist, because it means you can find and figure out stuff on your own. Becoming good is a very long, very long process. It never stops. And for you to be good is an evaluation of someone else more than anything else, I think. But finding the own information, definitely. That's it. Just know how to look for stuff. This is actually a thing that I'm covering in Art Campus, how to look for ref and how to do research, because researching skills are actually quite important, because you need to be able to figure out what stuff is called, what types of rocks are called, what types of buildings are called, what types of construction methods are called, all these things you need to know. But you learn them on the fly. You do something, you figure out, I'm not that good at that, you tackle it, and then you move on. Lisha with a +11, she asks, do you guys think compositional grids and rules are overrated or limiting, and why? I do not. I think they're awesome, but I think people are using them in the wrong order. I think people put down a grid and compositional rules and then stick to it, which is great if you want to make like 18th century feeling images, because that's when most of those rules were made, and they fit that. They're not as dynamic. It could be your illustration style.
Yep.
What I like to do is I'd like to make these thumbnails like I've been showing, get the mood in, get the sketch in, then test my sketch to these compositional rules. And if I'm like way off, I'm like, oh, okay, you know, it's probably not going to work. Because the one thing that the compositional rules will always have is if you kind of stick to them, your image will feel nice in a kind of a classical sort of way. If you can combine that with your modern interpretation of the mood and the angle and the thing.
Yeah.
Or just do what Noah does. I mean, everything's centered.
Yes, just stick everything in the center. If it's not centered, it's wrong. Noah's compositional rule book. It's a very, very short rule book.
Yeah.
It's not centered and a nice triangle just right there, and it's so wrong. So yeah, I personally do not get all of the grids and rules and stuff like that. I see people just using them and abusing them and just coming up with really, really awful paintings because of it. And I think if they focused more on just whether something actually looked right or not before they bothered with any grids or anything, they'd be much better off.
Yeah, exactly. The grids can bog you down, but at the same time, they can totally save your image when you feel like you're getting way too stuck on something. And meanwhile, I was looking for something else, but I can't really find it anymore. Anyway. So let's see, let's go to the next question. Am I getting something that's uploaded very high? Darren, hello, Titus, Noah, and Suzanne. Oh, shout out for Suzanne, that's nice. Would just like to say hello and keep up the awesome work. Ah, I thought that was a question. This is turning out great. You guys truly are an inspiration to our work. And I appreciate that you all take the time to help out with courses and such. Truly amazing. Well, Darren, thank you.
You rock too.
That was awesome. That is pretty good. I like that.
That's the best question.
I'm clicking this. Maybe it's another compliment. Maybe it's a question. I don't know. I haven't read it. I don't proofread things. When putting together a portfolio, do you recommend showing a variety of skills or focusing on one area? I've heard a lot of different advice about this. Yeah, I would agree that you would hear a lot of different things about that. I can see that. I would agree with that as well. I could say a lot of different things about this. It depends on the person It depends on the field. It depends on what studio you want to apply for. It depends on what seniority position you want to apply for. I like one area because I'm more of an all-in kind of guy. You know, showing that you can do one thing really, really well. The reason why I say that, the reason why I say that is because there is a higher chance that you will pop out, stick out above the crowd because you're good at this one thing. The problem is if you're quite junior and you do that, people think you're a one-trick pony. So I would predominantly show that you do one thing and then leave enough room in your portfolio that you can show that you're doing the other things as well. At least that you have some sort of knowledge about it that you can show.
Yeah. For me, I tend to side more on the focusing in than the diversifying, at least in the beginning. Yeah. You know, the only reason I did well early on is that I was super focused on something that, especially at the time, was not very popular. Environment art is not that popular, and that makes it way, way easier.
History hates environment art.
I remember the old, like, salon rankings where they actually ranked the type of art and how low landscape painting was in the rankings. Yeah.
If it wasn't for
they
very
always Italian merchants,
we wouldn't get them. If the old rules still applied and Italian merchants hadn't gotten rich enough that they wanted art, we would not be doing landscapes. It would only be portraits. Nice message.
If Americans didn't make them look really good, then we'd have a real problem. American fans.
You convinced me in signing up for art camp. Wishing Noah well on the Legendeering. I wish I could join. In the meantime, small staff note. Could you open a window?
Sure.
Because I'm like near like a heat source, which is not just me. And I'm like boiling. Leisha asked the question. Would you be lovely enough to explain the key difference between concept art and finished art or illustration and how the two potentially can intertwine? It's the magic question. Illustration is the simplest form. Illustration is meant to be viewed by people as is. Concept art is meant to be viewed other people can do stuff with it. It's never meant to be the final image. It's never meant to be pretty. Anything that is that and still labeled as concept art is false. It's probably marketing art. That doesn't mean that concept art can't be nice, but you don't make it because you want to make nice images. You make it because someone has a problem and wants you to work overtime and be miserable.
I think so many people are confused by that. I think so many people think that concept art is that marketing illustration that they see. And then they get into it and they're like, that's what I'm getting paid to do. I have to paint 38 lanterns a day. That's my job. That's my life. Yeah. I have to become a lantern guy. I'm the best at lanterns. Actual job.
You have it. While we're on that, I will just look for something and I will show the people here because I don't think I've ever showed it. There you go. Exclusive. a exclusive to show what, here it is. What a lot of concept art is actually more about. These were so good. So good. Here you go. I will share my screen. People, meet the real face of concept art.
Nice.
Making girders and that kind of stuff. Oh, but also make a destroyed version.
Ooh.
And indicate what the
destroyed I-beams.
Yeah.
Well, that is
What do we, oh, cable clamp. This was interesting. You see how many files go into making a single cable clamp? How many iterations? When people see the finished landscapes in my portfolio and ask if I ever design stuff, well, yeah, but I usually don't want to show it because it's this kind of stuff.
It's this. Wow.
So there you have it. That's the difference.
That's concept art.
Fun. It's a lot of fun. If you love problem solving, yeah, you'll love concept art. If you're problem solving your thing, done.
You want to paint pretty pictures? Illustration might be better.
Yeah, stick to illustration. You'll have a lot. It might be better because you won't go insane and you won't be depressed at work. That's it. Let's see. Oh, this white screen's making me. Well, there you go. How did you jump the tiny barrier between being an eternal student and being a concept artist? Not only about ability, but self-confidence. Ooh, self-confidence. Fake it. I faked it.
Yeah.
I was terrified. Yeah. I was absolutely terrified. I still am most of the time when I take a job. I'm like, there's no way this is going right. So you fake it. You put up a huge ego and say, no, you know what? I got this. This is easy. You're like, on the inside, you're terrified. Like, I'm going to get fired after day one because they see right through me and I'm a fraud. But on the outside, you're like, no, it's easy. I got it. No problem. It's fine. No. Design 60 buildings in the day? Yeah, yeah. Like 2 hours. No problem. You got no choice.
Taking self-confidence is the.
No, you broke up, Noah. Wait. What was that?
Faking self-confidence is the only way to get by.
It is the only way, definitely. I don't think we ever jump that barrier. I think someone pushes you over when they give you a job, and you go like, oh, shit. And then they ask, can you do it? You go like, yeah, sure.
Yeah, I can do that. Yeah, I don't know.
You can't say no. We've discussed this before, so I kind of expect you to know this, but we covered the thing that as a concept artist, you can't say, I don't know, or no, I don't. It's not a thing. I think deep down, we're all eternal students. I think everyone feels that way. Everyone feels like they could always get better. I think the biggest step in becoming a professional is understanding where that feeling comes from and letting it go when it comes to getting stuff done, right? You always feel that way, but you learn to prioritize it into your personal time and your professional time. Because in your professional time, you need to be the professional. You need to be the one saying, I can do this. I know how to do this. And you can just break down or whatever in your own time, which is what I do.
Yeah, I have mental breakdowns. Trust me, I like breakdowns if my things are going like badly and stuff. It's awful.
On a very serious note, I came really close to depression, and I've had one burnout, and I came very close to second burnout because this job is extremely stressful. And it was in a time where I didn't really know myself very well or how I thought very well. This is also something I cover in the course. Actually, that will be the very first week. We will talk in depth about how to deal with feelings, where they come from, how to set yourself up for success, and how to deal with that kind of failure that you have. Because I see too many people going to a depression or going to that mode where they feel that their work is shitty and not be able to get out of it. Sometimes you need other people to push you out of it. But when you're on your own, it is so difficult that you need to be very well equipped and you need to know yourself in a way that you can get yourself out of that. And that's what I'll talk about in week one. I think that's pretty important. Like, all jokes aside, that's actually is pretty important because it's serious.
It's really important.
Well, it's a little long on that question. Plus 14, we broke it. Plus 14. This is an interesting one. Do you guys work with a fixed palette or you pick colors as you go? Maybe do color comps before starting the final piece. What do you do?
Whatever I feel like.
Kind of whatever. I mean, I'm a concept artist. Yeah. I steal colors from whatever image I feel best suits the mood that I want. If it's my own work,
steal colors.
Movies,
you steal colors.
But I'm a concentrator. I need to get shit done in 4 hours. I use whatever I can to get things done. Luckily, I think
Sorry. I just pick random colors. Just color picker. You know, I swear some of my paintings have begun with yellow. Would be cool, and that's the entire basis for the painting. So And these days, I don't know. I think I'm in a gray phase. So all my paintings are just getting grayer and grayer.
Just gray's good.
Really, really gray. Gray is wonderful.
With the last painting I did, the ziggurat one with the, I thought, you know, I want hostile yet inviting. So I went for the sickly toxic green with an inviting comp. And I found a really cool image of a sulfur mine in Indonesia, which in the midtones was fantastic. So what I did is I cut out all the extreme contrast, kept the midtones, used the midtones as a base for my color sketch. And then I just kind of had a nice base, and then I went from there. Again, all of that is recorded. The only thing you have to do is enroll, and you get all of the goodies. Again, as a concept artist, what will happen a lot of the times, let's say you're working on a sci-fi game. Someone says, I want this to have the same color palette as Alien. You're not, as a concept artist, not actually going to make up your own color palette. What you do is you look at Alien, and then you use that color palette. And then as you're making the painting with that base, it will change, and then it will be your own. Because you have different design restrictions. Therefore, it will always be different. But you gotta learn to let go the idea that you need to reinvent the wheel every time. There's no time. You get left in the dust by everyone who just thinks it. That is that question. Alexandra asks, is working in New Zealand / Australia that bad? Well, Australia just closed down a huge studio, so...
The last AAA studio that was even there. And keep in mind, they had already laid off everyone, but, it was the last actual studio. So, as far as, like, in-house jobs, it is bleak. There's some mobile and indie studios and stuff that certainly higher, but it is not the place to go get work. Furthermore, if you're freelance, it's fine because you're freelance. On the downside, they have some of the worst internet in the first world. They're supposedly a first world country. They have awful, ungodly awful internet. You have no idea. And you have to pay so much money for it.
That's the thing. I was going to add my 2 cents, which in New Zealand buys you nothing because Nutella is like $8, which is
stupid.
$8 for hazelnut chocolatey paste. Crazy. Thank you. You do need to get everyone in here. It's not getting weird at all. It's just kind of, this is art, Ken. Let's see. Mathieu is asking, hey guys, thanks for this. My question is about skill specialty. I'm more effective as a line artist, but due to my situation, I need to work remotely. It seems like the demand out there is more painfully heavy. Any recommendation for where to go work wise if you're just doing lines? I don't know.
I don't know either.
I don't know.
Yeah, learn how to paint more, honestly.
That will help you out.
Not as much work doing just line work.
Yeah.
People pay for paintings. Just how it is.
I don't know. Maybe look into storyboard. Even a storyboard artist still do a lot of line work.
Yeah, you can get by.
If you want to be in games, storyboarding for cinematic divisions in games, that could be a thing. All right. I saw an interesting question just now. All right. Vitor asked, is Titus Art Camp exclusive for environments, or is it possible to use the knowledge in other concept art areas like characters? Well, Some of the knowledge is transferable, especially the way you need to behave and think. That will be exactly the same. But there is a serious portion of the art camp which will be on a very technical level on how to tackle environments and environment composition specifically, which is unfortunately not as transferable. So while I will say that a big portion is very viable, definitely not everything is transferable. So if you want to do characters, but you also want to do environments, it will be a good thing. If you only want to do environment concepts, I wouldn't really recommend it. There would be too much of a disconnection after a while. You'd only get benefit from the first 5 weeks, probably, and then less and less. There are not a whole lot of upvoted questions anymore. I see a question for Noah. I'll do the question for Noah. Okay. The question for Noah, what do you personally think about what makes you better, makes you a better artist than another artist? What makes you stand out from the others? Well, it's not your face, because you stole that from me.
Because I look identical to you. The face is so creepy.
Look at that. You see that? We have non-completed ears, both of us.
And then we found out it was a deformity, which was sad. But, you know. Anyway. Secrets to art. Better. It's a tricky one. Like, how do you tell if someone's better than someone else? It does depend largely on which field we're talking about. If we're talking about concept design, usually the design is the most important thing. If you're coming up with really original, compelling, crazy, awesome designs, and you're an awesome designer, then you're going to be known for that. If you're an illustration, if you're a better illustrator, if you can better illustrate a certain mood, a certain story, a certain character, a certain world, then you're probably a better illustrator. Believe it or not, it actually doesn't have that much as far as technical skills go. And someone can certainly be technically better, but does that really make them a better artist or not? Not really. I see certainly technically competent people that produce miserably boring paintings that I have no desire to look at. So I think making stuff that's interesting really does set you apart.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would agree. That's it. That's a done for that one. While I'm waiting for some actual questions to get upvoted, I'll actually go back to some of the reviews. So let's see what is going on here. Perspective is a tricky one. Again, some balancing, some light and dark balancing. It's like, overall, I think these kind of images are cool. There's a lot going on. There's a nice kind of color range. But in places, it's struggling with edge definition and then how things are balanced. And I would, meanwhile, behind the scenes, ask Noah real quick to look at the chat. Oh, you are good.
I just look so we can talk about secrets.
It will be a nice announcement. Okay. So there's quite a bit going on with light and stuff, which is distracting us. So these lighter portions are kind of distracting us. So what we want in this composition is to really have a strong connection between the foreground character moving into the background. And we need to arrange elements in such a way that we can actually do this, right? So that's the thing. Also, close to only being on the left side of the canvas, which means it's very hard for our eye to start moving around over the whole canvas. So maybe arrange some stuff on the right side here that we have more to do. That's it.
Sweet.
So we go to the next one. Oh, there's a lot. There's a lot. This one is by Matt McCherry. Awesome atmospheric depth in here. It's great. I love it. This is kind of the same problem where everything in this case is on the right side, and we need a stronger foreground element to carry it. So what you usually have is foreground, midground, background in a very clear stacking order, and this is kind of missing a foreground, which makes it hard to know for us where to come into the image, how to read this, and what the depth is doing, right? So you have these cool pillar basalt shapes here. So what you could do is you could add some of those like really big in the foreground, right, in a cool way that lead us into
I do really like the value control and lighting on those. They're cool.
Yeah, the value control in the background here is awesome. That's really good.
Also, the scale is not reading at all for me without seeing that figure down in there.
Yeah, because you're missing
it. I think when I first saw it, I thought those things were actually pretty tiny. So it's hard to get that scale.
Yeah, it's hard to see because we reach the character pretty late in the viewing stage. Which makes it tricky. This is a by Mon. So let's see. Colors are cool. Values are cool. I think from a design point of view, the only thing that I would struggle with. So this is a nice image. This is a nice composition. It's very very focused, which is great. But there's a lot of these design elements are too unclear. I can't quite figure out what's going on in a lot of these. And I think part of that is maybe because you haven't zoomed in. So when you zoom in like this, you really have to start defining shapes, right? You really have to start, oh yeah, this is how that works. And which is something that I didn't used to do for a very long time. And now that I've started doing it, I feel much more comfortable about my designs as well. So getting into the nitty gritty of that would be good.
Yeah, I think the general settings, yeah, pretty good. But I think you're right that just clarifying some stuff would be good.
Mm-hmm. The ability
to work. Squint at it looks great, but if you actually start looking at things, they don't really make too much sense. So, yeah.
Yeah, the ability to work clearly is pretty important. That people can see. This is an image by Marina. Start by saying that this angle is awesome. This is really cool. It feels super dynamic and high up. That's great. What to say? I feel that the lighting on the dragon is stronger than the lighting is actually on the character. There's a greater value range going on in the dragon than what we have on the character. Other than that, general rendering thing. So you could take this piece pretty far rendering wise, but in terms of setup and composition, the really strong, I need to pick a different color. The really strong curve that you have in there doing that is really good, and it reads really well. I don't have a lot to say. I think this is just really awesome. That's it.
It's working pretty well. I think maybe the silhouette of the dragon is a little bit stumpy looking. Like, for instance, I'd like to probably see a little bit more of his far forearm. Like, you don't really see any of it, I guess. Something to break that up a little bit. I think the foreshortening you have to be really careful with because it can make it just look like a really dopey-looking character because it compresses everything. So I might look into that, but that's probably about all I'd say.
Yeah. She was asking about the composition that she wasn't sure. I think it's pretty good, actually. So. That's it. Shockingly little to say. We kind of have to start wrapping up here though. There's still like a lot of work left to review. I see someone asking a question, which is it realistic to follow your dream even if you don't know if you're going to make it or not? The choice between solid, good paid board work and lower paid dream job and no certainties. I would go for the dream job, hands down, no matter what the pay. Hands down.
I mean, I think the whole idea of a dream job is that it's not certain. If your dream job is certain, you either have really low expectations or you're just really, I mean, I guess you just really easily satisfied with anything. Because I mean, if your dream job is like Walmart, then that is doable. You're like, I got this. I can nail this. That's fine. Yeah. And if you're happy doing that, that's great. But if we're talking dream jobs here, like, oh, if only I could, there's probably something between you and that dream job, if it's actually a dream job. Because if it was not that hard to do, you probably wouldn't just be fantasizing about doing it. You'd probably have already done it. So, yeah, I think it's sort of the definition of things. And, yeah, I think for us and probably everyone else who has done art professionally, it's probably a case of we chose that choice of I'm going to try to do this dream job thing. And if it works out, great. If it doesn't, I will probably be homeless.
Yeah, it is very often kind of an all-in situation. I remember having a conversation with one of my teachers asking me what I wanted to do. And we had to list like 5 different jobs that we could consider. And for the first 3, I filled in concept artist. And for the second, or for the last 2, I just left it open. And then we got into the conversation. He was like, you kind of answered everything the same way. Like, you know, number 1, concept art, number 2, concept art, number 3, concept art. What if that doesn't work? Like, what do you mean doesn't work? I don't know. Nothing. I don't know. I haven't thought about that. I don't want to think about that. What do you expect your chances are of success? He asked me. I was like, I don't know, pretty fucking small. Pretty small. But I can't think that way. Because if I start thinking that way, what's the point? I know I'm chasing my dream. That's in the back of my head. That pressure of failing, that's constant. So might as well just pretend that I'm going to make it and fake it until you actually do and have that ego that you put up kind of take all the hits of all the shitty stuff that comes your way and keep flying through. But the working your dream job, doing what you love every single day, how is that not the best? How, because it's your life. That's what you do. You exist, and there are certain hours that you exist, and if you could spend them doing what you love, it seems like a pretty good risk reward investment to me.
Yeah, makes sense. Thanks.
All right, we get a +7. Thanks for my previous questions. Well, I think thank you for your previous questions. It was a pleasure answering them. I returned to school 5 years ago, and now I'm going to start my career, but I'm 30. The age is important for the recruiters to start as a junior concept artist? No. Not really.
No. Nobody cares.
Nobody really cares. The younger the better because you're cheaper, but in terms of skill, it doesn't really matter. So if you're the kind of guy that says, "Oh, you know what? I'm willing to work for their salaries. I'm willing to take a pay cut just to get into the industry," which is something that I've done multiple times. I took a pay cut to go to a better project so I could then get better work afterward. It's kind of a shitty thing, and something that you really have to very carefully assess. But age in itself, I've had instances where my colleagues were 6-7 years older than I was with the same experience level. So like, okay, it doesn't matter at all. Like, just go for it. Recruiters are kind of weird anyway. Try to do that differently. Let's see. Actually, we have so many questions gone through already. Can the course be self-placed and still get feedback while going through it? Is there something I will be missing if I get a little bit behind? No, I think the forum and the Facebook should provide a good, like, community for you to fall back on, that kind of stuff. So if you kind of fall behind, it's not going to be a problem. The only thing that you'll actually miss out on is the opportunity to be included in the weekly review sessions, because you'll obviously miss those. But you can scroll back on the forum, see everyone's old assignment, because that's going to be a thing. Everyone has to post their assignments online, all the documentation that they have as well, which is going to be a lot of that. So I don't think you're actually going to miss anything. And I hope we create a community that's nice and friendly enough that will sustain itself even after we're not actually doing the course. Because me and Noah, we've both seen the community at its absolute worst, when people would just get hounded for nothing. And I think we're both, as Suzanne as well, and almost everyone we know from that newer generation, so sick and tired of that. So sick and tired of seeing that happen. So a self-sustaining community where you can learn at your own pace, in your own way, all for it. All right, let's see. There's a lot of uploads for some stuff. Is there some stuff to the course? Something got bumped. Okay, let's see. Holly asks, hey guys, thanks for doing this live stream. You guys are awesome. Thank you. I cannot hear that enough. I really can't.
No.
You think it gets old, but then
all day long.
Doesn't really. Goes.
This is why I do like magic events and stuff like that. It's just to get told how awesome I am all day long.
Great. I mean, after 14 hours, it gets kind of my question is twofold. How do each of you deal when it comes to burnout, and how do you pull yourself out of it? Also, how do you improve when you feel like your art has become stagnant? Any questions? Those are good. The first time I had a burnout, I dealt with it by not doing anything for 6 weeks. And I mean like barely getting out of bed, because that's the problem of a burnout. You don't do anything. It came in the summer. I lost that whole summer. I spent most of the time in bed, not doing anything. Just kind of sitting, eating, watching TV. Getting out of it, being pushed out of it by friends, family, and a social kind of gathering. And after a while, you do feel energized. But it's a lack of energy. And it's like what I talked about before. When you don't really know how you work, how your brain works, how you interpret things. Everyone interprets things differently, negative signals, but learning how to deal with them and how you interpret them is extremely important, because then you can see all the warning signs. My burnout came because I did not recognize any of the warning signs at all, and it hit really hard.
And
how do you improve when you feel your art has become stagnant? How do you got any tips, Noah? How do you do that?
For me, typically it's been, if I feel like I'm stagnant, like it's not getting better, it's usually a case that I probably need to go back to the fundamentals in some way. And a lot of that comes down to maybe I'm not doing enough thumbnails. Usually, maybe I'm not using enough reference. Maybe I'm not doing enough studies. Maybe I'm not, taking enough time on my work anymore. Maybe I'm not, doing work that I'm really passionate about. And going back to some really fundamental things of, all right, here's how to make pictures. Am I doing all these really important things? And usually I find out, hey, I haven't used a piece of reference in 2 months. Oh, that's why. I'm just rehashing the same stuff that's been in my head forever. So you get realizations like that, that tends to push your work forward. I do try to do a fair number of studies and stuff to keep my skills fresh, to learn new things. That's at least how I do it.
For me, when I feel super stagnant, it usually has to do with the fact that I can't really get into a nice flow. And to promote Art Camp again, which is essentially what we're kind of trying to do here, I'll talk about how to revamp that space and setting yourself up in a mentally and physical way, like your physical space, that you can do that. Because when you feel good and you're in a space which allows you to work, you're more easy to reach a nice state of flow, this hyper concentration. And in that state, you feel much more free to experiment and fail. Usually we don't want to do that because we think too much about what will other people think? How can I use this image? But when you're in the zone, all of that disappears. So setting yourself up for the best way you can, that for me is a big way in getting out of that stagnant nature. Really mix up how everything is arranged, how my mind is arranged. And I will come up with different priorities. I will experiment. I'll do really weird stuff. And in making those failures and not caring about them, I can kind of push forward and push through it. Cool. Let's see. My throat is starting to hurt a little bit, so I'm about to wrap things up. I see who's saying, man, the answer to the dream job question got me so pumped. Thanks so much for this, guys. You are very welcome. You are very welcome.
Oh, yeah.
And as a treat for all the people who are still here and who haven't
put up with us for so long,
I would just like to say a very personal thank you. We've been going to this for hours, but it's kind of like people, you're helping us move forward as well with this. So that's really cool. I mean, it's this kind of community. Wow, I feel comfortable running this kind of art camp, you know. So I'll answer, what is a good number? Five more questions? Is that okay?
Yeah, five is cool.
Five is cool. Someone asked that if it's too late to find the event page. I'm sorry, it kind of is too late.
It's too late.
It's almost been like 3 hours. All right, let's see. Question number 1 out of 5. Ursula asked, Titus, people mention a lot generic designs are bad. I have, however, often wondered if there's a place where the line is drawn. Do you cover what is a good design in the class? Yeah, I do, actually. I do. It's a very personal thing, what is good design and what is bad design. And it's very much based on the project. So the fun thing is that because you can take your own project and run with it, you can then make the, like, personally attest if it's good or bad, but also because there's all the documentation, others can evaluate whether it's good or bad. And this is pretty harsh, but again, reality of the job. So we will definitely cover what is good or bad. Yeah, just get ready for that. Let's see. That was 1-4 questions to go. Let's see. I'm scrolling down because I feel that when I scroll down, I'm missing a lot because some of them aren't getting bumped, I think. Oh, this list keeps scrolling. Are there any, like, down here? But holy cow, there are so many questions left. This is insane. It's more like comments, more like questions, right? Oh man. Wait, I'm trying to find find ones. Quick one, really quick one, doesn't count. Lester asks, I study illustration and I want to ask what you all think about internships in Concept Studio in order to start out the branch. Do it. Wonderful. As soon as you get your foot in the door, that's good. Golden. Love it. Tech asks, I'll select it. What does it mean when someone says your concept art has no design? Well, it means that you probably took a bunch of generic elements and didn't give it enough of your own spin. People can relate to it too much to everything else, and they will go like, this is generic. This is a generic pool. There's no design. No design is actually the wrong word. It does probably have design, but it's the same as everyone else has seen. For me, from my point of view, from concept, this comes because you haven't asked enough questions about the who, what, and why. These are my three pillars, which we talk about in depth, the who, what, and why. If you do that enough, you'll get unique design. If you don't do that enough, you probably won't get unique design. And you can be very, very close to something that already exists, but it has this little extra, right? Which you can then see. All right. Shin asks, let me select it again. Does this specific art camp cover how to combine photo and 3D assets with 2D painting, or would it be more painting focused? Thank you both. Really looking forward. Yeah, I do actually cover that. I won't actually go too much into actual 3D programs and stuff because I think it's not really relevant, but the process of photo bashing and working from stills is definitely something that we cover because it's a huge part of what we do. It will be a little bit more painting focused in the beginning because we kind of need to test what your fundamentals are to see how the feedback is going to work out and that kind of stuff. And painting is really important. But yeah, no, that whole integration pipeline, there's a whole week dedicated to that kind of stuff. How many questions was that? Was
there was three, right?
There was three? We have two. We have two more?
Okay.
Where am I?
There's a good question. Which one is better, a piece with bad detail but good design, or good detail but average design?
As a concept artist, I have to say, you got to go for the good design. But as someone who knows how the reality works, it's the other way around.
Yep. That's sad. That's really sad now. Now I'm sad.
It is the very sad reality that we live in these days. Just make sure you're fucking excellent at all of them. Just all of them. Last one. Ooh, strong one. Galicia, jeez. What do you have to say to people who think that using reference is cheating? That's what I have to say about that.
Yep.
For the record, using reference is not cheating. Not using reference is being an idiot. And we already covered that if you're an idiot, you can't do this stuff.
Yep. Don't be an idiot. That's all you gotta do. Anyway.
Using photos is cheating. Using reference is cheating. Using 3D is cheating. Well,
drawing
is cheating, and the best of luck in your art career while the rest of us bathe in awesomeness and moderate amounts of money that are enough for a reasonable living. So suck it. You can do whatever you want with the other stuff. I don't care. Have fun with whatever. Quick technical note, what is the schedule for the class feedback, etc.? Does it occur regularly at any time? Yes, it does. It's Wednesday to Wednesday. But more on that later on. It starts on the 24th. It runs Wednesday to Wednesday, so you guys have a very long weekend to work on stuff. And so I can have a very grueling and punishing session. So what happens is that on the Wednesday, the new video will be released, and I'll do the review session of last week's work. So you have like this beacon of panic in the middle of your week, which I like. It feeds me. And that's really it. I would love to continue. I would love to, people are still posting on Facebook and stuff. It is awesome. You guys are awesome for posting all this stuff. And obviously if you have any more questions about art camp, you can ask me, you can ask it on Facebook. You can ask me on Twitter. There should be enough info on the website, artcamp.com. I don't know if anyone has missed it by now.
Just keep saying it. Did you say it enough?
I would like it if you signed up. That would make me happy because then I can teach all my my stuff to you. There will be more guest artists that will be announced. I will do giveaways of stuff so you guys get freebies. So I will start giving
away. I'll be doing a video.
Noah will do a video. Al Brady will do a video. We got Alex Heath. We got reviews by John McCoy. We got books being given away. We got mini competitions. We got badges to earn on forums. We got, I don't know. Okay, maybe that's it, but that was a lot already. That was a lot already. So, yeah. Since I won't be able to speak anyway tomorrow, because that's gone, you'll hear a lot more bass after this, which is good. I would like to thank everyone for coming out. I would like to thank Noah very, very much for giving me this opportunity in the first place, because without you, there would be no concept, environment, concept, design, RCamp. So thank you very much. I would like to thank Suzanne again, who's been patiently working in the background for making everything possible on my end. See, I'm still alive. I look reasonably healthy. I got a little. It's all right. And to everyone who's signed up so far, it's really cool. I'm looking forward to it. And I will spam everyone with more information in the weeks to come. I hope you enjoy it.
Cool.
That's it.
Yeah, thanks again for everyone who came by, and we'll be talking to you guys again soon.
Yeah, and I hope this stuff has been recorded as well. Because I don't know.
Oh, yeah. It's all recorded. It's magically recorded.
Good. All right, everyone, thank you so much for coming, and I will see you around.
Yeah.